Hockey Night in Canada, brought to you by Ford of Canada, on behalf of Ford and Mercury dealers from coast to coast. Ahead, and participating retailers and record companies in Canada. The Bank of Nova Scotia, with nearly 1,000 branches across Canada to serve you. Molson, brewers of Molson Export Ale.
You'll form in Montreal, and memories of past Canadiens-Toronto Maple Leafs playoff rivalries. In the late 1940s, Frank Selke Sr. was general manager of the Canadiens, the late Dick Irvin was coach. In Toronto, Conn Smythe was in charge of the Maple Leafs. Hap Day was his coach. The teams met in the playoffs three times in the 1940s. The Canadiens were semifinal winners in 1944, the Leafs in 1945, and Toronto won an all-Canadian final series in 1947. Both teams featured great stars. Turk Broda in goal for the Maple Leafs, while in goal for Montreal was six-time Vezina Trophy winner Bill Dernan. In 1951, the Canadiens and the Leafs met again in a final series, Toronto winning in five games, all five going into overtime. The next Toronto-Montreal playoff meeting was in 1950. The underdog Leafs were beaten in five games in the final. That year marked the fourth straight Stanley Cup win for the powerful Canadiens, who were coached by Toe Blake and led by great scorers like Boom Boom Geoffrion and Rocket Richard. In 1960, Punchim Lac's Leafs met the Canadiens again in the final, Montreal winning four straight, with Game 4 remembered for this play, Rocket Richard's last goal. In 1967, in Game 6 of a Montreal-Toronto final, Gump Worsley leaves the Canadiens' nets as Montreal presses for the tying goal. But George Armstrong scores into the empty Canadiens' net, and the Leafs win the Stanley Cup. Now, 11 years later, the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Montreal Canadiens meet again in the Stanley Cup playoffs. Tonight, for the first time in 11 years, the present-day Montreal Forum hosts the Toronto-Montreal playoff game. Mike Palmateer, a playoff standout this year, will be in goal for the Maple Leafs. At the other end of the ice, the more experienced Ken Dryden will be the goaltender for the Canadiens. All of the players feel the pressure, the goaltenders most of all. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dick Irvin, and like hockey fans everywhere, I am awaiting what should be a great semifinal series between two of Canada's greatest all-time sports rivals, the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Montreal Canadiens. The Leafs are fresh from their dramatic upset win in the quarterfinals over the New York Islanders. The Canadiens have been waiting a week since eliminating the Detroit Red Wings in their quarterfinal round. A night of great entertainment is ahead, and our Stanley Cup playoff coverage will resume with the opening faceoff.
In an audio market flooded by exotic names, there's still a familiar one.
Good morning, world. It's going to be a beauty today.
A little dancing, a little romancing.
Coming at you, another blast from the past.
Ms. Jones, further to our meeting with...
All right, Joe, that's the latest.
Charlie 822, this is Baker 701. Come in, please, over.
The familiar name, General Electric, for reliable quality audio products. Canadian General Electric, working to give you your money's worth.
The Magic Organ, a special album of 25 all-time favorites. This 25 all-time favorites album. Stores now. Album $6.99, tape $7.99. The Magic Organ.
Live from Montreal, The Toronto Maple Leafs and the Montreal Canadiens in the first game of their Stanley Cup semifinal series. Moments ago, we spoke with one of the starting goaltenders. With Ken Dryden, goaltender for the Montreal Canadiens. Kenny, from a goaltender's viewpoint, based on your experiences against Toronto this season, what might you expect?
Well, I think the Toronto Leafs have become a very disciplined kind of hockey team. They have their more notable players like Sittler and McDonald, but it seems as if they've had a much better balanced attack in the playoffs this far, and I expect that they will play a more of an opportunistic kind of style against us.
The layoff, you have not played in a week. What's your feeling there? They've been playing.
I don't know. It's painful to start a series. When you're off for a while, it really takes some gearing up, and it's much more preferable to do it twice and so on. But I think that what you have in that first game coming back is genuine enthusiasm for starting. You may be lacking in...
Good evening, everybody. Danny Gallivan in the television booth. We look at our officials. John McCauley is the referee, Bayshore and Armstrong are the linesmen. And in a moment, we'll have a look at our goaltenders for tonight's game. There's McCauley, his back is to you. And the referee is checking on the light down neither end. Dick Irvin has informed you already that Dryden will be the goaltender. For the Montreal Canadiens in five playoff games with an average of two. Paul Mateer, what a sensation in the playoffs for the Leafs. He has an average of 1.73. And so the game is underway and it's ripped up on the boards to Williams. He's bumped and knocked down by Robinson. Now I had to look where he shoots it and he's ripped one wide. And the Canadiens go to the attack. There's a shot. Paul Mateer, the rebound. And the Canadiens with Lafleur. Shot. And Ray Sanul in there. Unremitting pressure in the first 19 seconds. There we're going to see some of it. Paul Mateer in front of that drive going down. Number 15 going in for the Canadiens. Ray Sanul. The Maple Leafs are going to make a change. Boutet is coming out with Butler. Carlisle is going on defense along with Glennie. Montreal Canadiens, they'll make one change. Réjean Houle goes to the bench and Lemaire joins Lafleur and Schutt. And there's a fellow who's been out, number 16 for Toronto, Jones. Montreal Canadiens, everybody up. And there we start again. The linesman waving out Lemaire and Jones. And the playoff games this year have been of long duration from the point of view of actual time. Savard shoots goal! And the Canadiens take the lead 1-0. Montreal Canadiens empty the bench. There you're going to see it. Lafleur getting it back to Savard. There's the shot, low shot, it's in there. And Montreal out in front, 1-0 after 23 seconds of play in the opening period.
Le Brigi Canadien, côté pour le numéro 18, Serge Savard.
And again,
numéro 10, Guy Lafleur.
Here's Schutt going in, and he fired into the far side. Way wide.
Canadiens goals scored by number 18, Serge Savard. Assist number 10, Guy Lafleur. And number 22, Steve Shutt at 23 seconds.
Lafleur was upended by Carlisle. He went into the boards. Lafleur going down heavily. And would you recapitulate, Dick, the scoring play?
It was Serge Savard scoring it, Lafleur and Shutt assisting at 23 seconds. And as we look at Roger Nielsen, Danny, our chance officially welcome Glenn Chico Resch of the New York Islanders, who is joining us in the broadcast booth for tonight's game. He would much rather be playing the Bruins right about now in Boston, but Glenn, welcome to our show. The Bruins and the Flyers, I can tell you, were tied 1-1 in the first period in Boston. This should be a pretty good series.
I'm looking forward to it. And welcome Chico Mustachio. What's new with the mustache?
Oh, yeah, that had been my good luck piece, Danny, till the other night, so it might be gone by next season.
Talking about the mustache, you just lost by a whisker, but it hurts just as much, doesn't it?
You got it, yeah.
Now the Canadians with Robinson feeding it to Gainey into the center right area with Chartrand. He couldn't pick it up. Turnbull had an outstanding series for Toronto against the Islanders, clearing it. And then it's propelled into the center ice area. Turnbull, number two, was doming out, is, of course, the big leader back there on the blue line for the Toronto Maple Leafs. And there's Turnbull to McDonald. Back to Turnbull. In over the line, and it's called on the offside with Sittler getting in there on the right wing.
That Boston Philadelphia situation, they started 30 minutes ago. It's 1-1 in the first period. Jean Rattel scored to give the Bruins a lead. Reg Leach tied it for the Flyers. And during the intermissions on our broadcast tonight, Don Marshall, who was monitoring that game here at the Montreal Forum, will have highlights for you from the Boston Garden during the intermissions.
For Toronto, Sittler at center, Ellis on the right wing, Maloney on the other side for the Toronto Maple Leafs, and the Leafs are in there checking the Canadiens. Chartrand ahead, and he missed. Jarvis with a gain. He's striding in there. Johansson has it for the Toronto Maple Leafs. Up to the line, it's swept back in. Now the Leafs clearing it out. It's propelled out by Turner. Savard takes a look. There's the long shot. 1-0, Montreal over Toronto early in the opening period as Maloney gobbles it up on the left side. He dashes in there, taken on the play by Mondu. Here's Johansson keeping it in. The shot, it hit a leg. Another shot, and Ellis' shot was blocked. Ellis then bumps Savard. Over it goes to Maloney. Maloney back to Sittler. Sittler on the backhand. It's a weak backhander. Now Maloney trying to shake off his man. Right over the bump. And he did score! Ellis getting it. And the Leafs have tied it. And now the Leafs empty their bench.
Glenn, you had to look at this play and the forechecking of Darryl Sittler, who did not give up. Here he is here, number 27 for Toronto.
That's right. Larry Robinson got turned around a little bit there. Dan Maloney makes a good play here with Cornwallier on him, shovels it out to Sittler, and Sittler, knowing where McDonald is all the time, threw it across, and Ronnie Ellis, and he shoveled it in.
Well, here's our top of the forum look at this one. Ellis didn't really get good wood on it, and maybe that threw Dryden just a little bit, but the Leafs threw it around very well and very quickly. We have a 1-1 game, as in Boston, we have it here in Montreal.
Toronto Maple Leafs, they have a lot of supporters in this building tonight. And they have tied it up.
Assist number 27, Darryl Sittler.
Now on the right side, a point going after it. Bouchard takes Jones in on the board. Now Williams turning on the left side, upended by Chartrand. A penalty coming up against the Montreal Canadiens. Chartrand is going off.
From the forum in Montreal, this is Stanley Cup 78.
Thank you. Al, a Lotto Canada package for Mother's Day. Isn't he a sweetheart?
He sure is. You can win up to $5,000 if your number matches one of the numbers chosen in the Mother's Day draw May 12th. You can win $1 million June 9th. You can win right now. Instant money up to
$500.
You gonna take us for dinner?
Well, I could, but I won't.
You get three chances to win with one Lotto Canada package. Now, that's my
kind of lottery.
Thank you. Make it yours.
2:43, Rick Chartrand off for cross-checking. Glenn Resch of the New York Islanders with us. And a big question, Chico, going into this series, would the Leafs play it rough against Montreal? What do you think?
I think they'll try to. The interesting thing are the important thing to look for is to see how Montreal does on their power play. If they can capitalize on Toronto's penalties, it could be different.
And so it's Turnbull in the center ice area, Toronto on the power play. They have Weir, McDonnelly, and Jarvis going in with Ganey. A weak shot by Jarvis. So let's pick up the alignment for Toronto on the power play. The Sittler, the Valley Cat. There's a shot by Sittler. He had something on that one. It wasn't a sharp angle, however. Point going after Sittler. Over it comes to Turnbull. There's the shot. He's wide. Now into the corner. Here's McDonald getting it back to Sittler. Score tied at a goal. Back in for McDonald. Out to Bobby Cat. There's the shot. And the rebound is cleared by Point. A minute and 10 seconds left in the penalty. Canadians breaking it up at center. Savard dragging the puck, killing off valuable seconds. To Lemaire. To LaPointe into the center ice area, coming up with Rajamoul over the line. There's the shot, and he whipped a hard one wide. Canadians still in possession, although they are shorthanded. Savard cleared it to the side. Valley Kett scooped it in. McDonald is bumped by Savard. Now they fight for it. They might get a whistle. They do. The face-off in the Canadian zone.
I don't think we will have Glenn comment on this fellow. You saw enough of him the other night. But I promised myself I wouldn't get you into that. But Lanny McDonald's the man who scored the goal for Toronto that won that seventh game at the Nassau County Coliseum the other night. The overtime goal that sent the Leafs into this semifinal against Montreal. Overall, during the regular season, these teams, the Canadiens and the Maple Leafs, played five times. Montreal winning four, the other game was tied.
Shots on goal, 4-3 at this stage for Montreal. And in the penalty, 41 seconds left for Chartrand to serve. Savard scoring for Montreal and Ellis for Toronto. Sittler on the draw. How long will he stay in there? Well, no, there's that whistle again. No doubt we've had more whistles in the playoff games this year than in any other 10 Stanley Cup years put together. Players have been complaining many times. Now into the corner goes, here's Maloney. It's shot down the ice by Rajamoul. Now the Leafs back after it. With Sittler, Maloney, McDonald, Turnbull, and Carlisle. Defending for Montreal, Uhl, Lemaire, LaPointe, and Savard. It's shot in there, in behind the net, picked up by LaPointe. He gets it high into the air, knocked down by Turnbull. He was upended. Here comes the Canadiens, hit by Lemaire. Lemaire over the line. Fires a hard shot. Almatier had that good reflex action going. Carlisle ahead to Maloney. The penalty has expired. At the Canadiens line, it's chopped out on the right side. Rajamoul got away from and McDonald checked. McDonald went into the boards heavily. The point back there. While the Montreal Canadiens up in the Maloney, the crowd reacted on that, and it's back into Toronto territory. Canadiens are making changes while the play goes on, and now Toronto with Butler. His pass stopped by Schutt. Butler, an aggressive, rugged little forward, fades over to the far side. Dumped by Robinson. Butler losing it to LaFleur in on the right side. And Glennie took his man out very effectively. Now into the center ice area, there's Nyrock. Nyrock dumped it rather delicately into the corner. Glennie fires it out on the right side. Butler is going as Nyrock. And it's knocked out by Schutt to the right side. LaFleur couldn't get it. He fell against Glennie. Now Boutet. Boutet, who is a fine skater, clearing it up on the left side. A bad pass to Butler. There's a good move by Mondeau, who's shut in front. Mondeau getting it in front. It's into the crease, and Paul Lethier is there.
Well, he had Steve Schutt alone in front, but he took a little too long. Tonight's Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Montreal Forum.
Of all the tools you use in business, nothing gets information across faster than long distance. Long distance gives you an interchange of ideas and gets things flowing back and forth. Long distance gives you control, gives you a feel for the situation, and lets you react immediately.
13-11 left. This is the first period. It's tied at a goal. Now they have to caution. Somebody moved prematurely. Toronto getting the draw. Johansson missed on the pass. It goes to center. There is Robinson. Mondu off his stick and Robinson again. Nyrop back to Robinson. LeFleur is turning on the right side. Robinson having difficulty. Being watched closely by Jones. A lead pass to Mondu with that head fake on the right side. Mondu over the line. And a booming blast high. Nyrop shooting it in behind the net. Mondu. Mondu trying to jam from the side. Turnbull after him. Here's LeFleur along the board. Again, Boutette. Pass to Jones. Jones over on the left side to Boutette. He just chopped it in. And now the Leafs are going to make some changes while the play goes on. And while Robinson lugs it into the center ice area. There's the shot. He rattled it off Johansson's leg. Turner. Pass to Turnbull, rather. Knocked down. Here goes to Lombard. And it was wide to that far side. Up on the left side. Boutette over the line, and he fed it behind Ellis. Now Weir trying to tie up the point. Cournoyer losing it to Ellis, back to center, and Turnbull to Carolina. The Leafs whip it in there. They move in, led by number 14, Weir. Along the board, Williams got in there too. Out it comes, and LaPointe chasing it. He lost it to Carolina. Score tied at a goal. This is the opening period. Offside against Toronto.
Before tonight's game, we asked veteran Leaf defenseman Brian Glennie if the Toronto defense had any special plans to contain the Canadian forwards.
I don't think the Toronto Maple Leafs are going to try and do anything different defensively. We're missing Boreas Salming. We've got five good defensemen. We're just going to have to pick up the slack and get a lot of help from our forwards and try not to give them too many three-on-twos or two-on-ones.
Off outside the Canadian line, and so far this game is not as bumptious as a lot of people thought it would be. There's Rice brought in over the line. Lombard taking a position in front of the net. He's tied up by Ellis. Into the corner they go. And Chico, did you think perhaps it would be question of laying on the muscle more?
I think everybody did, Danny, and I noticed Montreal, they not quite as intense as I expected them to be, especially their defensemen so far, haven't been really bearing down and taking the body. And like you say, maybe everybody's waiting to see who's going to be the first to initiate that sort of thing.
Canadians, everybody out for the faceoff. Ferguson, behind the net. Carlisle bumping with Risebrough. Risebrough got the worst of it. He went down, then he succeeds in tying up Carlisle.
Again, the reminder that in Boston, it's a 1-1 tie. In the first period at last report, the Bruins and Philadelphia. Donnie Martin will be along during our intermission tonight with highlights, scoring plays, and other highlights from that game.
Lombard against Carlisle. They struggle for possession. Risebrough in there to help out, along with McDonald. And that brings another whistle.
It's going to be interesting, Danny. I think Toronto's going to have to tie up Montreal's right side, because it seems to me that's where a lot of their plays have been starting from, and they got a lot of scoring power on that side, and they got Williams and Maloney, and who played well in our series, but I think in this series are really going to be tested, so that's going to be interesting to watch.
Okay, Chico, we will watch that rather carefully. Now it goes to the boards, McDonald. Long pass to center to Williams, ahead, Ferguson over the line, trying to get behind Savard, he did, and then Robinson cleared it out. Here's Cournoyer dashing down on that right side. Good move by Cournoyer. Bumped along the board. Back to the point. Here is Savard. Savard shooting it. Lombard hits the side of the net. Lombard shoots again. And it's wide to the far side. A penalty coming up for interference.
First Toronto penalty of the game, a result of the traffic jam in front of Palmateer when Lambert had the good scoring chance. It seemed he flipped the backhand high. This is Stanley Cup 78 from the Forum in Montreal.
As you roll along, shine on, taking time to have some fun, shine on.
foul, number 23 of the Toronto Maple Leafs, is a penalized player off for interference. It's a 1-1 tie. The Canadians with their first power play chance.
It will be Jones against Lemire. Lemire's shot. Lafleur, Lapointe, and Réjean Houle. And there again, we have somebody waved out of that face-off circle. We have two players, Lemire and Jones, vacate that area. Shot against Butler. Now the face-off back to Lafleur, over to Lapointe. And he couldn't get it. It's back to center. Lafleur handing it off to Lapointe. Lapointe back, it goes to Schott, he propels it in, he dashes in against Turnbull. Now here's Schott trying to center it, it's clear to the wing. Réjean Houle to Lapointe, over to Lafleur, shooting it. Behind the net it goes, they try to dig it out. Réjean Houle and Schott, Turnbull covering up, now Paul McPhear goes back there to help out. Now at Lapointe, Lapointe over to Lafleur. There's the shot, and it's off the body into the corner. Schott twisting and turning. Schott takes a look. What is he going to do with it to Lafleur? Lafleur closing in, shoots the rebound, and it's cleared away by Johansson. Kept in by the Canadiens, Lapointe. Lapointe takes the shot. Over to Lafleur. He takes a look. There it is. Up moves, but Jones is going to clear it away. He mugged at the center for Toronto. Over to Butler. Butler is shooting it right on. But it was from well out. 50 seconds left in the Carlisle penalty. A wave of four Canadians led by Lafleur. He gets to the other side. Takes a look. Takes the shot. It's off the leg. Now it's Jones with it, and he shoots it down the ice. Jones has been a standout, number 16 for the Toronto Maple Leafs, against L.A. and against the Islanders. I'm going to ask Chico later about number 16. Now Risebrough, good move on the right side. Back to Cournoyer. Here's Cournoyer taking a look. Behind the net to Risebrough. Back to Cournoyer. Oh, a beautiful defensive play by Ronnie Ellis. He got in front of the drive. Risebrough to Lapointe. Closing in. How much here is that? Lost it. And Ferguson shoots it down the ice. Great action here. The penalty has expired to Carlisle. Here's Lafleur. Getting away from Sittler into the center ice area. Shot blocked by Palmateer. Plenty up on the right side to Lanny McDonald in full flight across the line. The shot right on. Now Robinson behind the net to the other side to Chartrand. Chartrand to Jarvis. He spun around, knocked to the ice by Glennie. Maloney starts away on the right side, couldn't get very far against Ganey. Chartrand to Savard. Here's Robinson leading a four-man attack. Glennie got right in front of Chartrand, and that's what you call using your body. He took big Chartrand out of the play very effectively. Now the Leafs shooting it back in there. Here is Ganey from in front of the net, starting away with Chartrand. Ganey was upended by Sittler. Now Turnbull wraps Chartrand into the boards. He carries on. Here's Ganey off with left wing boards, and it hit Sittler and went to center. Ganey over to Savard. Savard winds up for the shot. Now Maloney on the left side. Passed across the ice into the center ice area. Robinson to Risebrough. Risebrough into the corner for Mondeau. Mondeau twisting and turning, getting it back. There's a shot by Robinson off Maloney's leg. Risebrough shooting it in front. Here's Robinson closing it again. And that one went off Turnbull's leg. Pressure here by the Canadians. Turnbull clearing it but not out. Here's Savard back on the right side to Cournoyer to Robinson. Robinson shooting it in there. Turnbull knocks it to the wing to McDonald. McDonald to Sittler. Pass back, shot by Robinson. Risebrough on the right side. Into the corner, shot from the sharp angle. Turnbull along the boards along with Risebrough. Now Mondeau trying to get in front. Back to Robinson. There's the shot. He's away wide with it. Penalty coming up.
With the Stanley Cup 78.
A year ago, we introduced Ford's protective vinyl coating to reduce paint damage caused by stone chipping. This year, we've extended its use from behind the wheel openings here and here to this portion along the lower body side area. So now there's even more protection from stone chipping. Vinyl coating is only one of seven steps in Ford of Canada's DuraGuard system of anti-rust processes. At Ford, we're committed to quality, reliability, and durability. And to you.
A lot of heavy traffic, Chico, right in front of the Maple Leafs net. Johansson gets called, but they aren't giving the Canadians any room at all.
No, they were hanging on there at the end. That whole shift wasn't very good for Toronto, and Johansson looked like he was just trying to stay on his feet. He was so tired hanging on to Cornway there, but if Montreal keeps this pressure up, it's going to be a long night for guys like Jimmy Jones.
Shots on goal, 13-4 at this stage. For the Montreal Canadiens, the score is tied at a goal. It is shot, Lemaire, Houle, Lapointe, and Lafleur on the power play for Montreal. Butler, along with Glennie, Jones, and Carlisle, and that's the second Leaf that has been tossed out of the faceoff. Lapointe shooting it, and Palmatier had to be careful on that 14th shot on him.
That's right, Danny. I believe that's where the first goal was scored, through the legs, and that's the one area where Mike is a little bit weak, is between the legs, just above the stick, because he goes in that V, and that's, you'll notice, where some goalies are vulnerable, say Tony Esposito, for example, as well.
Score tied at a goal. Back it goes, Lafleur gives it to Lapointe, long shot. Very coolly, that goaltender, Chico, looked after that one.
Oh, he's got it going, Danny. I'll tell you, when you've got that confidence flowing like he has, you just don't think anybody can shoot it by, and he's been doing pretty much just what he thinks he can do. Nobody shot too many pucks by him in the last seven games.
That was a shot of Mike Cullick at the Leafs bench. Another player waved out of the faceoff. Now Lapointe over to Lafleur. He winds up. There's the shot. Lemaire tried to center it. Glennie gets an opening and shoots it down the ice in a minute and 38 seconds left in the Johansson penalty of the Canadiens. To the power play attack. Lapointe drilled it into the corner. Oh, it was upended by Jones. Into the corner for the Leafs. Carlisle to Butler. Butler can't clear it out. Lapointe over the other side. Lemaire shooting it, and a weak shot goes wide. Butler bumping very solidly with Lapointe. Lafleur, a neat pass into Lapointe. He tried to get it in front. Back to the point to Lapointe. Getting it from Lafleur, the shot. Here's Lemaire trying to get it in front. He flipped it in front. Palmatier is there. Lots of traffic around Palmatier.
Nice light of camera in front of that Toronto net. Some football players in the audience should take note. That's a real line of scrimmage the Leafs are throwing up there, Glenn, at times.
Well, watch Glenn here. This is just the replay, but earlier he was giving somebody a tough time in front. And like you say, they're not really playing the puck, the defenseman. They're just trying to take the body. And really what they're doing, the same thing they did against us, is they're giving the shots from the outside, but they're really tying up that slot area. And so far it's worked well.
17-4, the shots. A minute one left in the Toronto penalty to Johansson.
Now 1 minute left in the penalty. Lafleur lost it to Ferguson, then got it again. Robinson and Glennie, two sturdy gentlemen into the corner, joined now by Lambert. Lambert to Lafleur. There's the shot out the leg, and the Leafs are going to lug it out. Jones docked at the center. Savard, back to Robinson, in over the line. There's the shot, blocked by Glennie. Lafleur circles to the right. Still circling. Goes to Robinson. Robinson into Mondu. A move, takes the shot, hit loose in front. Now Mondu, back to Lafleur. Lafleur gives it to Robinson. Robinson working it along the board. He attacks it, maybe, and a good play by Jimmy Jones. He shot it down the ice. Now there's just a half dozen seconds left for penalty. Here's the third going to go. Rebound. Oh, Carl assists on the rebound. A on the backhand. The penalty has expired. Johansson out of the penalty box. He touched it and called on the offside. What a move by Guy Lafleur.
Oh, it was an excellent play by Kenny Dryden. They caught him on a change. This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Montreal Forum.
Hey there with that booming shot.
Grow with us.
Hey there making that big stop. Grow with us.
Scotiabank Hockey College, where kids get playing tips and news from the experts and learn the good things about saving right now. No membership fee. Just open a high-interest Scotiabank Hockey College savings account. Hockey College, only at Scotiabank.
Come to Scotiabank and grow with us. Grow with us. Grow with us. Grow with us.
Mike Palmateer looks up at the board here at the Forum, Chico, sees that he's had 18 shots to 4 for Ken Dryden. Does that ever bother a goaltender? Did you see those statistics?
Not if it's still 1-1. He's got to feel pretty good.
It is Sittler at center, McDonald on right wing, Maloney on the left side for Toronto, Jarvis, Gainey, and Chatrot. Nyroff is shot. He hit Gainey. McDonald trying to get it. Close quarters down. Gainey upended by Johansson. McDonald kicked it to the line. Not out. Chartrand losing it. Here's Turnbull dashing into the center ice area. Over the line. The shot right on. And Dryden had to be careful with that. Turnbull played it smartly, getting in behind the defenseman.
And a reminder again that during the intermissions on our broadcast tonight, Donnie Marshall will be along with the highlights from the Philadelphia-Boston game at the Boston Garden. There's that last play by Lafleur, the great move he made, and the rebound by Jarvis, who missed with the backhand.
4 minutes and 31 seconds left in the first period. It is tied at a goal. Sittler will face off against Jarvis. Out of your picture, Johansson and Turnbull in over the Canadiens' line. Back it goes, and it's out over the line to center. Johansson feeding it in, and that is called on the offside. Chico, we might have a moment here to talk about some of the lesser lights who have played so well. Jimmy Jones, that happens so often in the playoffs.
Well, that's true, Danny. It's hard to believe. A year ago, he was in the minor leagues in Rochester, and now he's up being one of the important members of the Leafs. And he's the same as a Dougie Jarvis. You know, he just gets in there in the tough spots and does the job.
Now the puck in Toronto territory. Turnbull taking it on the boards by Chartrand. Gainey moving in. They fight for it. They may get a whistle here. They do. And the faceoff will be in Toronto territory.
You see, Danny, the way I look at it, the power play is very important here. You're killing penalties and faceoffs in your own end in crucial situations. And Jimmy Jones, he's asked to do that most of the time. And a team like Montreal with such a great power play, let's face it, the Leafs penalty killing is going to be the secret, especially if they're going to play rough. And like I say, he's got to get credit if he's going to do the job. And there, you see Kenny bobbling a little bit and only having five shots. That happens a lot. Kenny's probably cold down in the other end there, and it's going to be interesting to see the first good shot on Kenny.
Faceoff right now is in Toronto territory. Score tied at a goal. Back it goes to Robinson closing in. High shot. Paul Mateer. He grabbed that one easily. Chico, why did you blame yourself for that defeat? After all, the goalie.
What chance have you got when the guy is right on top of you as McDonald was?
Well, you know, your goalie's last line of defense, and you always think, boy, you could have maybe done something a little bit different. And a crucial goal like that, I just kind of thought maybe he caught me a surprise. And you always second-guess, Danny, when a goal that important is scored on you.
Yeah, but weren't there a couple of players in front there that could have taken McDonald?
Well, I'm sure other players feel responsible, too, but it's always the goaltender, like I say, that could ultimately change the fact. And if you don't, you always feel like maybe you could have done something different.
There's quite a hockey player, that's right.
Now Turnbull lugging it out. He stopped at the line by Shot going in. There's the shot, a very weak one against Johansson. Lemaire against Jones in the corner. Turnbull, a right wing pass for Butler to the Canadiens' line, and Robinson. The shot passes blocked. Now Shot finally gets it into Toronto territory. 3 minutes and 30 seconds left. Tavares in front of his bench. Canadians had to be careful there that they weren't going to get caught with too many men on the ice. Turnbull fires it off the glass. There's McDonald laying it back into the corner. Robinson took a look over his left shoulder, now lugs it and decides to go back to get some skating room. A lead pass to Lambert. Lambert is over the line, fakes the shot. Lambert over a goal, and Lambert whips it high from the sharp angle. Here's Robinson shooting it. He hit Cornwallier. Rise down.
Here a little bit, but it's funny, after all the good chances Montreal have had, and they kind of score on, like I say, a play that didn't look that dangerous. I see that on Dougie Riseborough, so he may have got the goal. Oh, they're giving it to him.
Canadian goal scored by number 12, Yvan Cournoyer. Assist number 8, Doug Riseborough. And number 19, Larry Robinson, at 17 minutes, 6 seconds.
So there's the announcement on the goal. Officially, it goes to Cournoyer. Williams slides a pass on the right side, and it's whipped in off the boards by McDonald. Montreal 2, Toronto 1, 2 minutes and 20 seconds left. Pass on the left side. Ray J. Ull, high pass for Cournoyer. Cournoyer fakes the shot. Now it goes over to Nyrop. He shoots it. He's wide with it. Now the point at the other side. Chasing it is Riseborough behind the net. Riseborough taken out of the play by Carlisle. Comes to the other side. Lapointe shot off the stick. Lapointe gets in fairly close. Takes the shot. Locked in front. The lead comes to the line. It's poked back in by Ull, the soft side, with two Canadians. Granted. Live from the floor in the Montreal, the Stanley Cup playoff.
Sit back and take a quick look at the John Deere line. Now for a closer look, see your John Deere dealer.
Chico, the man who just has been credited with the goal, Captain Cournoyer. 2-1, Montreal leading Toronto near the end of the first period. Savard it ahead. Now the ice could be... No, it's not icing. There's Savard over to Robinson. Robinson flicking it in. Big Chartres going after little Johansson. Johansson coming out, leading a four-man Toronto attack. They fire that shot. It's picked up by Ellis, and then he lost it. He didn't have it clearly, and he would have been into the clear. Chartres at the line. Here's Jarvis. Pass over to Robinson, over his stick, out over the line, and the Canadiens with Savard at center, waiting for the Toronto zone. Canadiens, 1 minute left. In this first period, Johansson from the right side, Robinson ahead to Gainey. Here's a break for Lemire. Lemire going in. Not much of a goal we can do about that, Chico.
No, I thought Mike played it real well. You'll see him go in off the post here, but Turnbull gets caught up ice a little bit. Lemire comes in and, like you'll see, beat him on the stick side off the post, and a great shot. Here it is again, Danny, and like I say, he's out there well in front of the crease, and he's got the angle, but when it's shot in off the post by a guy who can shoot the puck like Lemire, you know, you got to have more going for you than your talent.
Not the man. Canadian goal, scored by number
Carlisle ahead to Butler. The Leafs clear it in.
At 19:13,
the time of the third goal for Montreal. Montreal 3, Toronto 1. 20 seconds left in the opening period. Forechecking. Nugent for Toronto along with Butler and Jones. Now it's in behind the net to Robinson. Robinson off the boards. It's clear to center. Glennie is on it. He fired it back. Jones is tied up by Robinson. Picked up by Boutet. There's the low shot wide. Carlisle going in to pick it up, and that's the end of the first period. So a few observations on that first period for 5 seconds.
Well, I was surprised at 3-1 the way it was going there for a while, but anybody who's been watching the game can tell that it seemed to be a matter of time with the Canadiens getting so many good chances.
Okay, thank you, Chico. It's Montreal 3, Toronto 1, and that is the score at the end of the first period.
Well, it's kind of hard to describe what makes you go there. 6 feet of snow or it's spring, you go every time you get a weekend free. It's just a feeling you get from the very air you're breathing. Something that says you found it right where you want to be.
Well, in the summer, there's swimming and sailing. In the winter, there's ice fishing, skiing. In the fall, you tromp around these woods, and the colors are just incredible. There's always something different. And I don't care where you go, you won't find better country or a better beer.
So get the great taste that's Canadian.
Malts and Canadian. All year round, it's Canadian.
It's your kind of beer.
Patch roof leaks the easy way with Tremco Instant Patch. Use it in almost any weather to stop leaks on roofs, chimneys, and gutters. Instant Patch's exclusive formula of glass and organic fibers dries to a tough membrane that seals holes up to a quarter inch in diameter. Tremco Instant Patch by the makers of Tremclad, Canada's number one rust paint. Look for Instant Patch and other fine Tremco products in this Tremco Home Maintenance Center, wherever you buy paint or home care items.
At the end of the first period here at the Forum in Montreal, the Canadiens lead the Toronto Maple Leafs 3-1. But despite that score, you'd have to say the big story of that period was the play of Mike Palmateer in the Maple Leaf net. As Chico Resch mentioned during the course of the play-by-play, when you're hot, you're hot. He said Palmateer's playing with confidence. The Canadiens outshot the Maple Leafs by the incredible margin of 21-5 in that period. But it was a 1-1 hockey game until the final couple of minutes when Yvan Cornoyer broke the 1-1 tie, and then Jacques Lemaire made it 3-1 Montreal at the 19:13 mark. Serge Savard opened the scoring in the first minute of play for the Canadiens. Ronnie Ellis tied it for the Leafs with their first shot on Ken Dryden. But from then on, Palmateer took over until those final couple of moments. It's 3-1, the Canadiens in the lead. In Boston right now, it's 1-1, the Bruins and the Philadelphia Flyers. They are into the second period. Rattel has scored for Boston, Leach for Philadelphia. Donnie Marshall will have highlights from that game for you later on in this intermission. I'll also be chatting with Stan Weir of the Toronto Maple Leafs. And coming up next, a special feature on how hockey players become mentally prepared for a Stanley Cup playoff game. Stanley Cup 78 continues in just a moment.
Get away, make your getaway from the city.
More people in the world have been getting away with Johnson's than with any other outboard.
Don't go too fast.
Okay.
Okay, great. Use your brakes when you reach the corner.
Like all parents, we have the protective instinct, too, about life and security and the future. And that's what life insurance is all about.
And be careful!
Talk it over with Mutual Life of Canada. We've got children, too.
During the
course of the hockey season, but particularly at playoff time, you hear a lot of talk about conditioning. Are the players in good physical condition? But there's a mental aspect to this as well. So right now, a cross-section of some NHL personalities talking about how they get in mental shape for the Stanley Cup playoffs.
When we talk about a team being in good condition for the playoffs, we generally refer to physical conditioning. But what about being in the right frame of mind, psyched up and mentally prepared?
You know, people think that players only have to go out and work maybe a couple hours a day at practice and two or three hours for a game, but the biggest problem is mental fatigue. And this is a situation where the players are forced to perform under great pressure three or four times a week in the playoffs. Of course, this is all multiplied.
It's a long season, and when the time does come around, when playoff hockey, you play 80 games to get there. So you're there physically wise, but mentally it's draining. But I think that a team that gets themselves up mentally prepared for each game is a team that's going to succeed.
Just the idea of getting up for a two out of three series or a best of seven, when you know everything depends on you, it really takes a lot out of the players. And this is why some teams go for hideaways and others do all kinds of things to get the teams mentally set.
Well, to be prepared mentally, I think, in any contact sport is vitally important. And it's not a natural thing to go out and body check or be physical. And you have to prepare yourself mentally for it. If you don't, you won't do it.
I feel that mental preparation is probably 90% of the game. And in the playoffs, where you often have the combination of talent, hard work, and aggressiveness, a lot of it revolves around the fact that the mental attitude of a player will really determine the outcome of the game, because teams are, talent-wise, they're all very strong, and the aggressiveness is really the important factor.
For most people, it's not natural to get hit and not retaliate so that you take a penalty or something. So you have to take it and put up with it and dish it out too. And that's what makes the mental preparation that we're talking about so important in contact sports like hockey and football.
You're in the best physical condition you're going to be in, and from there on, how you play game in, game out is going to be mental. It gets a lot easier in the playoffs because there's a lot at stake. You get a new infusion of life. There's times during the season where the season drags and it's mentally hard to get up for games. But once the playoffs come along, there's no problem at all. It's really important.
You have to be in shape to play the game, and then the concentration that you have out in the ice, whether it's covering your winger or going in the corners or standing at net, they all play a very important part in the outcome of a hockey game.
You got a lot of players that might have had a bad year during the course of the year, and you know, if they get ready for the playoffs, they can really help our team. And over the years, I've seen a lot of big goals scored by players that haven't played all year, and they get out in the ice and they're ready to go, and they get that spring fever in them, and they drain it.
You know, Coach Shiro, if he has a specific game plan, it's very important that you stick to that that plan throughout the game. And if it means having one man in forechecking and then the wingers covered, that's the way we have to play. And when you get to the playoffs, it's a team that plays the best defense that is usually going to win.
If your mind's ready, I think you can go on and on in the playoffs. And I think it's really important for everybody to be sharp and be ready for these things, because there's a lot of money to be made.
Any club that has reached the playoffs and has gone that far, they are physically in shape. The coach has seen to that. The players themselves have seen to that. So it all amounts to that whichever team is mentally prepared for it. And that means that you have to almost 24 hours a day in the playoffs, think hockey, sleep hockey, eat hockey, everything hockey. That's why the players, families, and wives in the playoffs have to put up a little bit extra, because the fellas are getting themselves prepared mentally.
All of the signs are there that it's special. There are more interviews. There are more stories in the paper. There are more people asking you about them. There are more people at the games. There's more noise in the building. And all of those things just generates excitement and preparation within you. And in a sense, the playoffs are almost the easiest time for mental preparation, because most comes just automatically.
And when you come down to the ability end of it, teams that are in the playoffs, there might be one or two players difference in their ability, but it's a team that mentally wants that cup. The team that has mentally grind out 60 minutes of hockey, it's going to come out on top in the playoffs.
Whether it comes automatically or requires special preparation, one thing seems certain. Being mentally prepared is every bit as important as being physically fit.
Some very interesting observations on the mental approach to the Stanley Cup playoffs from NHL personalities. Coming up next, a conversation with Stan Weir of the Toronto Maple Leafs. At the end of one period here at the Montreal Forum, the Canadiens lead the Maple Leafs by a score of 3-1. Our Stanley Cup playoff coverage continues in just a moment.
With music like this, you get huge sound pressure. And if your hi-fi system can't take it, you get breakout. So switch to the new DynaHarmony by Hitachi. DynaHarmony is really two amplifiers in one, with a unique reserve circuit that gives you 100% more power when you need it, like now. DynaHarmony by Hitachi. 100% more power when you need it. DynaHarmony is at your nearest Hitachi dealer.
I've had this car for about 3 years and 130,000 miles, and I look after it. Like using STP oil treatment. A lot of drivers I know add STP to their engines. It gives your car that extra care I like having, whether I'm driving 12 hours a day or just around the block.
You free?
Yeah, get in. I never get a break, but my car sure does with STP oil treatment.
Our guest this intermission is Stan Weir of the Toronto Maple Leafs, who is from Ponoka, Alberta. And Stan, to paraphrase Danny Gallivan, where is Ponoka, Alberta?
Well, it's about 55 miles south of Edmonton, just off the main highway.
Okay, it's a good night for Northern Alberta, because in our second intermission, we have some guests from Edmonton who will talk about the Commonwealth Games. Have you ever played hockey in the month of May before tonight?
No, this is the first time I've ever played in the month of May. I think it's the first time for a lot of guys on our team, because we haven't made the semifinals since 1967, but we're looking forward to it.
Your first 3 years in the National Hockey League, Stan, you weren't in the playoffs at all. I was in California with the Golden Seals. Did you ever get a little down when you were playing with that hockey team?
Very down. After Christmas, we were out of the playoffs most of the time, and we had a lot of management changes and things like that, and I don't think it was a good place to play hockey at that time.
Let's look back to a happier time now in your career, specifically the last couple of weeks in that series with the Islanders. What would be the one or two key things, perhaps, in your mind that swung the balance toward your hockey club?
Well, I think one of the major reasons was the Maloney trade. I think that helped us out, in the corners quite a bit, and I think the...
Use an old cliche. Could you feel it?
Yes, very much so. After we won the sixth game in Toronto, everybody just knew that we were going to win that seventh game in New York. We just had that feeling.
All right. And you get down, but it didn't, like, they scored the first goal. I mean, you still had the feeling?
Well, once they scored the first goal, it didn't bother us at all. They hadn't shut us out all series, and we figured if we just kept working hard, the goals would come.
You know, they talk about the visiting teams. There's a lot said in playoff time about the crowds and the various arenas and the visiting teams and what effect it might have on them. But what about playing in Montreal? Have you ever noticed anything special about being the visitor here in the Forum?
Not really, myself particularly. I really enjoy playing in Montreal. I don't know, I just seem to get up to play against the Canadiens. I don't know why, but because they're so great. But I think we just come in here and work hard.
All right, what about now in Toronto? Because there's been a tremendous turnaround with this hockey club, and right now everybody is so high over the Maple Leafs. The team has improved over the last little while. Have you sensed an improvement in the atmosphere in Maple Leaf Gardens for the home team?
Well, I think the fans, the last two games in Toronto, they were really behind us, and I think that gave us a little bit of an edge. Before the playoffs started, we were a little down at the end of the season, but they've really come on strong lately.
Stan, off the top of our show, Kenny Dryden seemed to be just a little apprehensive over the fact that the Canadiens have had a weak layoff. From your standpoint, are you happier that the Leafs have been playing, or could you have used a couple more days' rest?
Well, I think we could have used a couple more days' rest. There's a lot of bruises from the Stanley series, which is physical, but I think we're going to be ready to play.
Okay, Stan, thank you very much. Stan Weir of the Toronto Maple Leafs, and live from the Forum in Montreal, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Every time you mix a drink, you've got an 80% chance of doing a good job. See this? 4/5 of your drink is mixer. And no matter what you're mixing it with, that 4/5 is going to make or break the taste of your drink. That's why you should be using Canada Dry mixers for every drink you make. Because it's no secret, Canada Dry makes better mixers. So don't take chances with taste. You can't lose when you use Canada Dry mixers. Anytime, all the time.
There have been more Ford vans registered in Canada than any other make. And now your Ford and Mercury dealers have a wide selection of 1978 vans, all with Ford's out front van design, all with a move forward engine that gives you more move around room inside. Ford's got them all. From hard-working business vans to Ford's freewheeling van and cruising vans, customized. There have been more Ford vans registered in Canada than any other make, and a wide selection to choose from at your Ford or Mercury dealer now.
CBC covers the Commonwealth Games August 3rd to August 12th.
The Montreal Canadiens lead the Toronto Maple Leafs 3-1, and while all that was going on in the ice here, Donnie Marshall was locked in our isolation booth back in the basement here at the Forum, watching the Philadelphia Flyers Bruins. Donnie, what's happening with the Boston Bruins?
Well, Dick, 5 minutes in the second period, score is 1-1, and it's an interesting game, and everybody expects a lot of hitting out there. The teams would really go at each other, and it's not happening. They're taking penalties, but the play is relatively quiet. The goalkeepers are coming up with excellent stops, play relatively wide open, and I'd like to show you a couple of goals. First, the Boston goal by Jean Rattel, and it's something that, you know, young hockey players can learn. He sort of isolates himself, moving over to post a box, take a pass, take the fast shot. Oh, I think we're into the Philadelphia goal already.
Whoops, a little technical
problem here. Here's the Boston goal now. Rattel is going to move up the ice with Bob Miller. He's going to cut over and play Bob Daly. They're going to make a two-on-one just as they cross the blue line. Jimmy Watson playing wide, looking for the winger coming up the other side. It's a fast wrist shot, short side, and he scored the goal. But it's something young hockey players can do. Isolate yourself on one man, make the two-on-one. Here's a goal by Philadelphia. Bobby Clark, working as always, behind the net, feed it out, cross ice to Bill Barber. Into McLeish, it'll come back to Reggie Leaf. Good passing play, and Mike Milbury comes sliding out over to Clark. Clark more or less has a shot, but he feeds it back to Leach. Reggie Leach with the open end. We'll see it from behind the net. Take a look at this.
Is this a power play?
This is a power play. Chambers is moving out, playing Clark completely. And Reggie Leach just has the open net to tuck it in, and that made the score 1-1, a power play goal by Philadelphia.
Two teams that play somewhat the same style of hockey, Donnie, the hard work, the grinding, and what have you.
They work hard all the time. They sort of force each other. They lay it on in the offensive end of the ice, and they don't give you a chance. It's tough on a defenseman because they're taking you into the boards continuously.
All right, thank you, Don, and Don will have more highlights of the Philadelphia-Boston game in the second intermission. Now back to this one, and here is Danny Gallo.
And there you see the shots on goal, 21-5 in favor of Montreal after one period of play, and the Canadiens leading 3-1. Second period with Captain Sittler at center getting the draw, and ooh, to Robinson up on the left side. Gainey tried to pick up in full flight the Jarvis pass. Now Johansson playing it behind the net. Turnbull, he hit the referee McCauley. Let's see, is Regin Ull going to be able to tie him up for a whistle? Yes, he does. Chico. We were talking in between the periods. You said the Montreal Canadiens 3-on-2 is deadly.
Well, you know, Danny, anytime you've got as much movement as they do on a 3-on-2, moving the puck around, it's going to cause movement by the defensemen, and that's the whole secret on a 3-on-2, trying to get one of the defensemen out of position, and Montreal does that more consistently than any other team that I've ever seen.
There's Johansson being chased by Rick at the line. Robinson gets it into Gainey. There's the shot. He didn't have too much on that, and it went wide. Turnbull behind the net, solidly by Gainey. McDonald rolled it down into Canadian territory to Robinson. Up on the wall at center to the left side to Gainey. He puts on the brake. Jarvis getting in front. There's the shot by Ray Chandler. And he had plenty on it. Accuracy was not particularly good. He was at least 8 feet wide. Into the corner. Robinson playing it up to the line. Now the Canadians going out on the left side. The shot of Paul Mateer in among the spectators.
How do you size up the other series? Well, I think I'm kind of like everybody else, Danny. I'm kind of sitting on the fence waiting to see what happens. Here's the replay by Steve Shutt. I was just thinking, Danny, the Canadians keep this barrage up on Mike, and they happen to get the next goal. I wouldn't be surprised if they replace him just to give him a rest.
There's the shot right on by Nyrop. 3-1, Montreal leading. We are into the second period. Here's the Fleur, dipsy doodly, and the pass went between the skates of Shutt and Lemaire. Now it's Lafleur upended in the Toronto zone. The Leafs get rid of it. It's down to the Canadian line. Nyrop swings the pass over to Lapointe. He knifed it ahead. Jones is on it for Toronto. Here's Carlisle. Carlisle runs into Lemaire. They struggle for it. Back into the center ice area. Boutet, he crosses the line with Jones. And Butler is shooting it. He's away wide with it. Shutt got rid of it. Back into the center ice area. plenty. Two boots ran into the point. That was a solid jolt on the line there, and a penalty coming up. From the Montreal Forum, this is Stanley Cup 78.
I'm sure you will never forget the time you have Bredor, because everything you've heard about Bredor is true. You may find some at your brewer's retail now.
I hate to use the old cliche thing. This is an important penalty.
There you are, Chico.
Oh, hi there.
But are you going to tell us about the penalty?
Well, I guess it looked like a good check, but John McCauley, a little closer to the scene, I guess he got his elbow up a little bit. But Toronto hasn't been doing much offensively, Danny, and this is one chance to kind of get on track offensively. So it's a big, big power play for the Leafs.
And they get a goal, they're right back into it. Right now, they're being outshot 23-5. Now the puck in the Toronto zone. They're trying to get their power play into operation. They have Weir, along with Valiquette and the Canadiens. Jarvis coming up with it. Williams is out there, too. So is Sittler. There it goes. Jarvis is shot right off. Oh, Paul Mateer had to be so quick on that quick shot. Jarvis was up and in the corner by Valiquette and the Canadiens. Supporters react to that. Toronto having difficulty getting their power play going in majestic strides down on the right side. Sittler, then he falls. Robinson has the fails to clear it, but Haney is going to get rid of it. And 10 seconds left in the penalty to Guy Lapointe. Montreal 3, Toronto 1 in the second period. Now Turnbull coming slowly on the other side to Williams. The Leafs shoot it in. There's Valiquette going into the corner. After him is Savard. Now it's Savard working from the corner, coming out. Hitman Savard. Here's the man cutting into the left side. Palmateer came out and cut down that angle beautifully. Into the center ice area. Sittler takes the pass back to Valiquette. Sittler back goes to Valiquette. He cleared it into Weir, trying to get it in front. And it's gobbled up by Savard.
Palmateer in that last chance, Chico Rush came out on Lemaire when he came in on that left side right here. What's the goalie thinking about? Do I or don't I?
Well, you can see there that Lemaire really wound up, so it gives the goalie a chance to move up because you know almost certainly he's going to shoot the puck, do anything else with it. Here's that earlier save, a much better save really in the fact that Mike had to be a little quicker, but he played the angle very well on that first replay we saw.
26 seconds remaining in the penalty to Guy Lapointe. Don Marcotte has scored for the Bruins in the second period in Boston. They now lead Philadelphia 2-1.
And the face-off to the right of Dryden. Carlisle. Corner back to Carlisle. He faked the shot. Pass went by McDonald. Now Canadians with it. Out it comes. Here's Gainey along. To Savard. Here's Savard trying to get in front, and the goal comes off his glory. Chico, that's one way to.
Well, the funny thing is, the puck went between the two pipes. There was no net on the pipes, but the puck actually did go in. But I don't know if it was the goalie. I don't know if Mike Palmateer is tall enough to knock it off himself. Lanny McDonald coming back bumps into it, and if it wasn't intentional, it was one of the best unintentional moves I've ever seen. Because there you can see it. Oh, he knocked Mike into it. So I was a legitimate.
Hockey players wouldn't do that intentionally, though, would they, Jacob?
They wouldn't admit it, Dick, but. Worked out too bad, though, did it?
Well, gave a point spin in the penalty box, but the Canadians have had the best scoring opportunities.
Face off to the right here. 16-13 left in the second period. There's Carlisle in the corner. Forechecking, Lambert, number 11 for the Canadiens. Glennie back to Carlisle. Here's Lenny getting it out. The penalty has expired on the left side. Maloney clearing in. Ferguson dashes in. Here's McDonald for Ferguson around the net. It went through Maloney's skates and the Canadiens score in the match center. Off the corner board. Did they go? The shot, he took it from the net. And it's cleared away. Cornwallier couldn't get it. There's another shot. Now on the boards, Risebrough along with Glennie. And Glennie is one of the old-time cruisers and bumpers. He's a solid checker.
Tonight's Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Montreal Forum.
Introducing the patented Mark Collar from Arrow. Revolutionary. And that's fact. It's the first collar ever shaped to fit the human neck. Until now, men's collars have been cut like a tube. The Mark's ingenious shaping is like a cone. Result? A you've never experienced before. A new, crisp look with the neckband out of sight. The patented Mark Collar. Only by Arrow.
Coverage of the World Hockey Tournament continues on CBC Radio this coming Thursday afternoon, 3:30 Eastern Time, as Team Canada meets Czechoslovakia. That's Thursday, 3:30 p.m. Eastern Time on CBC Radio.
That's Risebrough, I think, with that shot, and then they opened that, Cornwallier couldn't get it. He was being number 14, Weir, who was doing the checking. Now it's behind the Leaf net to the corner. Here's Mondeau. Mondeau trying to center it against Carlisle. Cornwallier jammed under the play by Glennie. Carlisle ahead to Maloney. Broken up Cornwallier over to Mondeau. Randy McDonald upended by Mondeau. And the Leafs, I think, thought there should have been a penalty there to the Canadiens. Cornwallier back high. And the Leafs starting out over the line. Here's Ferguson at center with McDonald on the other side. Long to the right side. Mondeau skedaddling out over the line. Gives it to Cornwallier, who pumped it into the corner. And the teams are making changes. Johansson, the fine young defenseman, out it goes to center. On the left side, Lemaire. Lemaire with the point, who takes it at the lead. Broken up by Boutet and brought in by Lemaire offside.
Well, there's Guy Lapointe, and Danny, I think Canadian watchers will agree that the playoffs began toward the end of the regular season and in the playoffs with the Detroit series in particular. Now tonight, he has come a long way back from the eye injury that kept him out of action for a couple of months' time.
Montreal 3, Toronto 1 in the second period. Now, that's goes to Boutet from Turnbull ahead to Jones. Jones drops it back, and Lemaire was there. Lemaire knocking it back. Johansson to Jones. Jimmy Jones turning at the line into the center ice area to Butler. Butler over the line. Here's Turnbull getting set. Shot partially blocked there by Lafleur. Now on the left side, Lafleur took the pass. The center winds up, and the shot goes off Johansson's stick. The Leafs starting back. Boutet missed Butler. Robinson. He fades back. Now ahead, Lafleur couldn't get her. There's Boutet turning at center. Ripped the shot off the board. The Leafs going in after it. Butler meeting Robinson, who cleared it to Gainey. Ahead to Lemaire. Robinson coming up on the right side. It's off the corner board. And Glennie fades in behind the net. Glennie coming out. Good move to get away from Risebrough. Glennie shooting it. Butler was upended by Gainey in the center ice area. Butler lost. Here's the bird. Ahead to Risebrough, hitting the Toronto line. Spun around and knocked down by Glennie. Now Glennie has it for Toronto. Sipper at center. Sipper at the line. Takes the shot. Dropping it by. Cleared away by Robinson. Gainey on the left side. Beating center over on the left side, and his shot goes just off the board rather gently. Carlisle to Williams for Sittler. Gainey playing it back. Nyrop to LaPointe, and it's returned to number two, Nyrop. He starts high. He cleared it from center. Just over a dozen minutes left in the second period. 3-1 for Montreal. Here's the Tiger. Long behind the net, Nyrop cleared it to the line. Glennie stopping it. In it goes to Williams, a shot. And it was knocked down and picked up by Nyrop. A hit to Ray Jambul up on the left side. Carlisle staying with him rather reflectively. Carlisle along with T-shirt. And Ray Jambul, the four of them, are doing some solid shoving there in the Toronto zone. Now it's Sittler. Center. He prevailed against Uhl, gets it ahead to Williams. In there goes Sittler for checking on Nyrop. At the line, Lanny McDonald pumping Bouchard. Bouchard carries on ahead to Uhl. Uhl's pass picked off by Turnbull. McDonald, Kearney. Here is Turnbull down on the left side. Over the line, the shot.
A one-goal hockey game with the Canadiens out shooting Toronto 26-8. Chico, I'll let you talk about this one because it handcuffed Ken Dryden.
Well, we were just talking, Dick, before you got up here, that Kenny being inactive, you wonder what he's going to do on some of these shots because he's been hasn't had much action in there. It's just a case of, what can you say? I mean, you want to apologize to all your teammates and everybody, you know, that's a Canadiens fan, but everybody knows you blew it, and it's really the break that Toronto needed. It'll be interesting to see how that affects both teams, because that's the one thing you don't want to do as a goalie, Danny. You don't mind giving up a good goal, but give anything away.
Well, you mentioned in the out shot, a goal can put them right back in, and there's where Toronto is right now.
I would have to think they must feel pretty fortunate being 3-2, outshot 26-8.
Here it comes again as Turnbull comes down the left side. He let this one go from about 5 feet inside the blue line.
I guess I don't feel so bad. Excuse me, Dick. I know he scored three on me, and I thought maybe it was just me, but Kenny's one of the best goalies, and if he can let him in from there, I guess I shouldn't feel too bad.
He's having a great playoff. That's his fifth goal. That's a playoff high for him. Last year he had four goals for Toronto. That was Turnbull. Now it's Turnbull in front of the net, and he cleared it on the left side. Striding down is Valiquette. He's not going to get that unless he gets...
A 20-star collection of super mellow music. Paul Anka.
I don't like... Sleep alone.
Us.
Do you know where you're going to?
David's Soul.
Don't give up on us, baby.
Dan Hill.
Sometimes when the time, the honest things do.
Disc $6.99, tape $7.99 in the stores now. Love songs.
Savard shooting it. It's loose in front. Down on the ice is Turnbull. He covers up for the faceoff again in deep Toronto territory.
Now, Boya Salming was released from hospital as we look at that last chance for Cornwall here. The flip that got through and fell on it. Salming out of the hospital definitely will not play in the first three games of this series.
And Chico, will he be any good for the rest of the year being out that long with that injury?
I think a lot depends on what the series stands when he gets back, Danny. You know, if he can get into it emotionally right off the bat, he could still decide, be a deciding factor in the series.
He's a hockey player, Salming.
This is his kind of hockey.
Will he be gun shy?
I don't think so, Danny. I really don't.
Okay, here's Cornwallier. Back at the line. Up on the left side, Lambert. Feeding it in. Cornwallier goes around the net. Cornwallier's centering it. Now it's Bondu playing it back in for Cornwallier. He got away from the Johansson and sent it back. Now Bouchette bodied by Cornwallier and Lambert. Cornwallier skating out there as if he were 21. Puck is back down into Canadian territory. Here's Savard. Savard into the center ice area. Cornwallier couldn't pick it up. Then he knocked it to center. Here's Robinson coming in. Right. Robinson losing it finally to Carlisle. Glennie ahead on the left side. Here's Bouchette to Weir. Weir hitting the line. Good move by Weir. Finally coming up for the Canadiens. Weir was tipped after making. making that excellent move.
With the score, Montreal 3, Toronto 2, this is Stanley Cup 78.
I think I'm going to leave this on. What do you think?
Joyce would kill you.
Every year I take it out before we go home. This year,
if you keep rubbing it, you're going to wear it off.
Come on, give it time, eh? That's not so bad.
No. It's been the same deal for years. Clean up the cottage, share a little Molson Export, grow another beer.
Guys, just quit hassling me. Hand me a beer, will you?
It's in the cabin.
Molson Export Ale. It keeps on.
Interesting turn of events here at the Montreal Forum, with Leafs having just scored, Ian Turnbull making it a 3-2 Montreal, and now Guy Lafleur draws one of his infrequent penalties. He's off for tripping as he dumps Toronto's Stan Weir. At the 10:02 mark, the Leafs trailing by one, and now with Lafleur in the penalty box, Toronto power play chance.
They have Sutter, McDonald, Dolly Kett, Weir, and Turnbull. They're all in over the Montreal line for this faceoff. Now from the faceoff, McDonald trying to get it finally on the boards. He cleared it into the corner. Tavares gets it down the ice. 9 minutes and 48 seconds left in the second period. Leafs in their own zone to organize on this power play. Beer heading the attack. Out to Weir in the center ice area with Sittler, McDonald, and Ballycat. They're over the line. Weir shoots it off a leg. Into the corner, Weir again. He gives it to Ballycat. Ballycat back to Sittler, off a stick. Into the corner for Weir, bumping. Here it goes, Ballycat. Behind the net to McDonald. Here is Weir. Back to McDonald. The Leafs have some pressure here. Sittler shooting it, off a stick. Ballycat couldn't reach the rebound. Now it's McDonald trying to get in front. Here's Weir. Weir against Lapointe. Jarvis shooting it down on the right side. And the Leafs controlled it rather well there. And there was a high stick against Toronto with the advantage. That is, making contact with the high stick. The faceoff was back into Leafs territory.
Much better power play, certainly the first minute anyway, Chico, for Kate the last time they had a chance.
That's right, Dick. It looks like they've got a lot of confidence on this power play. You'll see they're taking their time moving the puck like Derry didn't panic, and they're really moving it around well, which is what you power play. And just a couple near misses there where we could have had a tie game. I just want to say, excuse me, on that last goal on Kenny, do you remember in January when Paul Holmgren scored for the Flyers?
That's right.
In 1 second, it was in the same spot, up high, and kind of a knuckleball, and that was a similar shot. I'm not saying Kenny's weak there, but it's kind of interesting. The last time I was in the Forum, I saw Kenny beat on a similar shot by Paul Holmgren.
54 seconds left in the penalty, and the Leafs on the power play. They trail by one, 3-2. McDonald whips it in off the glass, caroms to the other side. Here's Williams in there. Williams to Sittler. Over on this side of McDonald, he winds up, shoots, kicked out brilliantly by Dryden. That was a good shot by McDonald, who can really unleash that shot. Now Nyla along the boards with Maloney. Here's Williams with it. Williams into the corner, taken into the boards by Robinson. Here's Maloney. Robinson hooked it again. Maloney going after it. Williams, somebody has lost the glove there. It goes to Sittler. Sittler back to McDonald. Over on the other side to Turnbull. The shot off the stick. Sittler into the corner. Now up on the left side. And Rajan Ouel, with 5 seconds left in the penalty, flicked it into Toronto territory. Now the penalty has expired. Maloney down on the left side, in over the line. Beam shot turning with Lafleur and Mondeau, in over the line. Back to Mondeau. There's the shot, blocked by Carlisle. Now shot going after it. He lost it to Maloney. Canadians getting it with Mondeau. Back to Lafleur at the Canadiens line. Lafleur ad-libbing his way to the right side. Finally, he has to go back. Losing it. Boutette with Jones in over the line for Toronto. Good skating there by Boutette to keep from going offside. With Jones in over the line, they finally lost it. Now it's Jutt. Jutt coming away into the center ice area. Off the knock to the ice by Jones. Here's Boutette. Good. And again, he fed it right in front. Tavares And to LeFleur on the right wing at center, hitting the Toronto line. Jones sticks with LeFleur. Now he's cleared back to center. Boutette coming down with Butler. Good move again by Boutette. He has an excellent move to the right side. Number 15. It's held against the board.
This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Montreal Forum.
Every summer night seems like a battle you never win. Then fight back with a secret weapon. Strong, effective STP insect repellent and killers. Battle the bugs with STP. Take command.
Available at these stores.
Bench, he was just on the penalty bench. Interesting statistic. The Leafs have now had 20 chances against Montreal this season, including regular schedule games. They have not scored a power play goal.
Now here's Ferguson. Chartrand jammed in on the boards by Williams. They get a whistle. Chico, I'd like you to comment about the mobility of that Canadian defense. You notice, not on this play, but the four we broke for the commercial, Robinson was moving all over the place to clear the puck.
Well, I think you talk to any person that watches hockey, and that's the one thing they marvel at is Canadians don't have one mobile defense or two. They got three. Robinson tonight, the way he can twist and turn and do the things he can on skates for as big as he is amazing. And he might not even be the best one. You watch Savard some point, and they do it just as well. So, you know, that's really their strength as far as most people are concerned.
Kurt Walker is on the ice for the first time. Canadians straight out quickly. And then quickly they lose it to Carlisle. Nyrop knocking it up on the wing. Puck rolls. Canadians territory, 6 minutes and 18 seconds left in the second period, 3-2 for Montreal. The point at the line, the shot is blocked, he gets the rebound. In the air. Now Glennie to the other side, Williams catching up with it for Toronto. Long pass, and it goes behind to Butler. There's a pass intercepted by Carlisle into the center ice area. His pass is cleared. He stopped. Bombear swinging in on the right side. Bombear. And Carlisle gets to the feet of Bombear. That would have been some collision had he had that on. Now back it goes to Bird, shooting it nowhere near the net. LeFleur going after Butler. Got a piece of him. Now Jones at center. Ran into Robinson rather gently. LeFleur dipping it into the corner. Leafs doing some forechecking earlier in the period, but now the forechecking. However, Toronto got rid of it. Down the ice it goes, and Savard is back there icing against Toronto.
In the first period, we heard what Brian Glennie had to say about the Canadiens forwards. Well, here's what Larry Robinson did. The Canadiens' problems with the Leafs forwards.
Guys to watch on the Leafs are usually their big scorers, such as Sittler, McDonald, Ellis, but forget about the so-called small guys, the guys who don't score as much, like Boutette and Butler. They're hard workers, and I think our main objective probably is to, you know, keep the front of the net clear and hope that Kenny stops the big shooters.
So the face-off to the left to Paul McKeer. Shots on goal right now, 26-9. But in that very, very important statistical story, not much separating the teams, Montreal 3, Toronto 2. There is Savard whipping his shot. Oh, here, blocked it. On the board, Maloney and Gady struggle. And the play is stopped. How proudly and successfully have these two teams, the Leafs and the Canadiens, on the Stanley Cup trail over 48 years. And between them, they've won the Stanley Cup 29 times. 18 for Montreal, 11 for Toronto. So it'll be a tripartite competition among three Canadian teams when Vancouver gets up there. Chico, you're thinking of the Islanders.
It's going to be tough to catch them, Danny. They got quite a jump on us.
Now Rajan tied up by Johansson. He cleared it down on the right side. Robinson chopping it back. Jarvis
get clear of it. Less than 5 minutes to go in the second period. Turnbull knocked it to center. Now then Jarvis rolled it in, and it is called on the offside.
Live from the Forum in Montreal, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
This is my Mercedes.
Hold tight. In Gans to my Cadillac.
Cadillac? That's for Granada. Alone at last, beloved.
Beloved?
Where's my bride?
She got that Mercedes with another man.
Another man?
The new Ford Granada. Looks like Cadillac and Mercedes, but at a lower Granada price. When North America needs a better idea, Ford puts it on wheels.
Johnny Holman looking rather furtively at the clock. Said 4:40, and that's what it still says, but now it's 4:35 left in the second period. There's Lemaire going after it. Turnbull takes over. This is the second period. A 3-2. Montreal 3, Toronto 2. Robinson ahead for Gainey. Johansson broke it up. A pass to Sittler. Sittler to McDonald off the boards. McDonald having a hard shot high and wide. Here's Turnbull trying to keep it in. Now it goes to Lafleur from Gainey. Lafleur over to Gainey, and he missed the pass. Gainey centering it back. Johansson working it for Toronto along the boards to center, and it's whipped back in there by Lemaire. 3:50 left in the second period. Now Maloney. Lafleur trying to tie him up. Here's Sittler into the center ice area against Nyrop. Sittler trying to get in there. And Savard came back and picked it up. Here's Glennie on the backhand. He's backhand. Picked off by Lafleur. Over to Lemaire. Drop pass for Lafleur, and Lanny McDonald wheels on the right wing to center with Sittler. Now Lafleur has it again. Up to Lemaire. Lemaire to Nyrop. Back it comes off the boards. Lapointe moving in. Got by Maloney. Now Maloney gets it from Glennie. He has to contend with Lambert. To Lapointe, back in it goes. Glennie off the boards, lost it to Lemaire. To the other side, over there goes Lafleur, jamming in on the boards with Lanny McDonald. And it's now tied up partially by Lambert, who finally gets it clear, centered it. Glennie failed to clear it out. Here's Lafleur making the move. He centered it. In there goes Lapointe. Leafs breaking it up, but the Canadians keeping it in. Lemaire by Sittler. Back to Nyrop. Throws again for the shot. And off Palma's here. Pinkle, tell me something about the shooters. I don't mean the big guns, Charles and Sittler. We know about them. Some of these lesser fellas like Buffett and Valley, Gett and Jones and Johansson, they play so well in the playoffs.
Well, they shoot it against us, Danny, and actually, Lanny McDonald scored two goals. Of course, he got the big one, and Darryl only scored one. But we controlled the guys we were worried about. But like you say, in the playoffs, it always seems to be somebody else that will come up big for you, and that's what Toronto has going for him. Danny, just one thing I noticed there. You know, you were talking about all the whistles. The thing they're not doing is they're not icing the puck or tying it up when they're in trouble in their zone, and that's why they give Montreal so many good chances.
Nyrop, you notice there, came up with a big play to knock Ellis down. Ellis was ready to move on Molesta down on the right side. There's Ellis coming in with Weir. Back to Weir. Backhand shot to Ellis. He flipped it wide. Down on the right side, Mondeau with Cournoyer. Cournoyer on the right wing over the line. Cournoyer shooting it. Off the stick. Rysbrough centering it. Glennie has it for Toronto and flipped it down into Canadian territory with less than 2 minutes remaining in the second period. Just the one goal separating the team. There's Tiger Williams. He got by Nyrop. Williams trying to get in front. He does. And the shot is blocked on the short side. That was fine maneuverability by number 22, Williams. Minute and 41 seconds left in the second period. And you know the historicity of playoff performance. Canadians record some very thrilling and dramatic games. They were going to see some action with Williams coming out there. It was Lambert who made the save. I suppose the most memorable series, actually the 1951 finals, as Dick mentioned at the top of the show, he featured that. Five games between these two teams into overtime. Finally in Toronto in the 15, the Leafs won it in overtime. The late Bill Barilko scored the goal. That's a memory that will never be erased from the mind of the Maple Leaf hockey fan. And ironically enough, it was to be the last hockey game that Bill Barilko was to play in the National Hockey League. So the penalty parade has not been a strong, just five minor penalties so far. There's Ferguson. His big night, of course. The one he remembers most. Three goals against L.A. in that. Now Savard. In behind the net. There's Robinson from the corner. Out it comes to center. Jarvis. Deflected in. Kurt Walker is on again. He gets it to Williams. Williams starting out for Toronto. Ahead it goes to Ferguson. Ferguson gives it to Walker. The shot on that slap shot. He waited just a little too long, and Robinson was over there to deflect it. That's why, Ron Andrews, I talked so often about the wrist shot. I've lost Chico. He's gone. I guess you're going to hear from Chico downstairs. There's Chartres. A minute and 17 seconds left in the second period. Next game in this series will be played here at the Montreal on Thursday night, and then the teams move to Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto for the third and fourth games on Saturday and Tuesday. And that will be the same schedule for the first three games for Boston and Philadelphia. Change that. Philadelphia and Boston will play on Sunday and not Saturday in the third game. And the Leafs. Everybody up. And there is Butler facing off against Jarvis, who gets the draw. Robinson behind the net. Butler is after him. Robinson gets a second shot at it, cleared it to the other side. Jones in on the boards with Savard. The Leafs are pressing here as we move into the final minute of the second period. Now Canadians starting out. Jarvis chasing a pass. Paul Mathieu covering up against Jarvis. Let's see. There's going to be an assessment of a penalty here with 55 seconds left in the second period. Boutet going off for slashing. So that makes it a half dozen penalties in the hockey game. And the face-off will be in deep Toronto territory. That will be advantageous, of course, to the Canadians. They'll be able to send every man in over the power play and operation. Here's the announcement.
2 minutes for slashing at 19 minutes, 5 seconds.
It'll be Lemaire, Lafleur, and Shutt up front. Scotty Bowman going with two defensemen, Robinson and Lapointe. The Leafs get the draw. Johansson fired it off the glass. And it's in among the spectators. So with 51 seconds left in the field, they'll face off again. In deep Leaf territory. The interest in this series, of course, is feverish. Coast to coast in Canada with these two great rivals, the Canadiens and the Leafs. And, of course, we have many viewers in the United States tonight. We'd like to wish them the best and a warm word of welcome. Now it's Lapointe shooting it. It's off a leg. Here's Lafleur going after it. Into the corner. Turnbull tying up his man shot. Now here's Lemaire trying to center it. Blocked by Turnbull. Lemaire takes a look. Gives it to Lafleur. Lafleur, what will he do with it? He gets it back to Robinson, winding up. Out in front of goes. Oh! Shot is robbed by Paul Mathieu. I want to see that one again. Shot was right on the lip of the crease. Now here's Lemaire. Lemaire giving it to Lafleur. Shot is in the slot. Will it go back to the point? No. Finally it does. To the point. The point. In off the board to LeFleur. 6 seconds left. Back to Robinson. Here's the point shooting it, and he wrapped it off Ferguson's leg. It's centered through the crease, and that's the end of the second period. A minute and 5 seconds still remain to be certified. And Boutet, Palmateer, has had 28 shots fired his way. Not as busy in the second period as he was in the first. Toronto has had 9 shots on goal. So the score at the end of the second period, Montreal 3, Toronto 2.
How to help provide early warning protection against fire. No two fires begin the same way. Sometimes they start as simply as this. To help protect your family, General Electric developed the Home Sentry Smoke Alarm System. When this sensitive device detects smoke, it sounds a warning, providing time for escape. The GE Home Sentry System. It could help save your family's lives. Canadian General Electric, working to give you your money's worth.
Lightning strikes twice. First, Thunderbird, a legend in style and personal luxury. And now, lightning strikes again. Futura, a dramatic combination of styling and technology. Thunderbird and Futura, two unique personal cars in two sizes and two prices. Only at your Ford dealer. The better ideas keep coming from Ford.
The John Deere 400 tractor, a powerhouse of versatility. Rotary mower, hydraulic controls at your fingertips. You control the cut. Rotary tiller, rear PTO supplies the drive, digs deep and wide. Front end loader, steering lets you handle up to 600 pounds capacity with ease. And moving parts are enclosed for safety and quiet. With a full range of tractors and attachments, including snow thrower, there's no job too tough. Proof, nothing runs like a Deere.
Here at the Montreal Forum, after two periods of play, the Canadiens lead the Toronto Maple Leafs by a score of 3-2, and things turned around quite a bit in that second period. The only goal scored by the Leafs' Ian Turnbull. The Canadiens totally dominated the first period, led 3-1, but the Leafs tightened up. The Canadiens did not get nearly the number of shots they had in the first period, and it's a 3-2 hockey game, Montreal in the lead. Recapping the scoring in the first period for the Canadiens, Serge Savard, Ivan Cornway, and Jacques Lemaire did the scoring. Ronnie Ellis scored the Toronto goal in the first period, then came Turnbull's goal in the second, and it's 3-2 Montreal. In Boston at the Garden in the second period, at last report, the Bruins, and a goal by Don Marcotte, have taken a 2-1 lead over the Philadelphia Flyers as that Stanley Cup semifinal gets underway. We are having some camera problems in our intermission studio, but nevertheless, Chico Resch has joined me. Chico, along with Danny Gallivan, up in the broadcast booth. And Glenn, I thought that we'd talk a little bit about inside the playoffs, and in particular, your specialty, goaltending. And one thing that you have to think about at playoff time, fellas see the opposition four, maybe five times during the regular season, and here we are back again with Chico's smiling face. What about familiarity? When you see a team suddenly five, six, seven times in the space of a couple of weeks, does it help the goaltender who gets used to the shooters, or is it vice versa?
Well, that's an interesting question, Dick, because I'd given it some thought this playoff. I think what happens is if you see a player too much, you don't like that, because that means he's getting too many good chances. And what you might do then is you tend to guess a little bit on certain shooters. And if you get into that type of a thing, then you can be in a lot of trouble. But I think just the psych of the playoffs really overcomes any guessing that a goaltender might do. So I would say, you know, really, it's a little easier for a goaltender in the playoffs because they're not getting as good a shot as they do during the regular season.
Is there such a thing as the trend of play sort of becomes a little more predictable when you see a team tonight, Thursday night, Saturday night, as opposed to seeing the same team once every 2-3 months?
Yeah, I think so a little bit, although the series changing back to different rinks. I mean, the play is unbelievable how it gets when a team gets at home and when they're on the road. So that's one aspect of it. And then, of course, you know, the fact that maybe a team does take the body a little bit more at home changes how you play. But I think the thing for the goaltender to look for is at home, they're not going to get as many good chances. But just like the seventh game of the Stanley Cup that we or the playoffs that we lost, one good chance that they did get, they scored. And so it seems even larger. But on the road, they're going to get a lot more, you know, better chances. But you plug up the slot area a little bit more at home.
There's the always predictable question to a goaltender playoff time, the pressure. You really feel it more, Chico.
Well, you know, Dick, I don't like to toot the goalie's horn, but I'm
go
not.
Right ahead.
I'm not saying that they're any more important than any other player, but I think they can decide more than any other player the outcome of a game. And you know, you're trying to eliminate that, but subconsciously it's all a goaltender. So therefore, I think he might feel the pressure a little bit more because, you know, he could feel that he either wins it or loses it.
Very quickly, it's got to be there when you go into overtime. Come on now. Got to be there.
Well, yeah, that's true. I do have to agree.
Okay, Chico Resch, who is joining us tonight on our broadcast, the Canadiens lead the Maple Leafs 3-2. At the end of two periods, Stanley Cup 78 continues in just a moment.
The Amway story has many chapters. This is one of them.
We felt trapped in a gray world, dead-end job, stuck at home, and then we discovered Amway.
We started part-time. We built an independent business, helped others start Amway businesses, too. We're building it our way, and that gives us a lot of satisfaction and fulfillment. We're living again. With Amway, you could make it happen.
See your Amway distributor.
And get the whole story.
We're saving $600.
We're saving.
This family has rented a Ryder truck.
We're saving.
And moved 500 miles.
We're saving $600.
By packing and moving themselves, they saved a lot of money over what professional movers wanted. True, when you rent a Ryder truck, you have to do the work yourself.
We're saving $600.
But if you just keep repeating how much money you're saving, you'll be amazed how much lighter those cartons will seem.
We're saving $600.
Now there's a new color film for the One Step that develops twice as fast. Get the picture. Polaroid's One Step, the world's simplest camera, and look at the new brighter SX70 color. The picture? You'll begin to see the image in seconds, and it's finished in minutes, twice as fast as before. That's fine. You never focus. You just press the button. A motor hands it to you. Get the One Step.
Hey there, dreaming of the sun.
Grow with us.
Hey there, looking for some fun.
Grow with us. Making sure the grass is green.
Checking out the listening scene.
Come on, everybody, grow with us.
Scotiabank. It's the place to save for the things you want now. A month from now. A year from now.
Come to Scotiabank and grow with us. Grow with us. Grow with us. Grow with us.
From August 3rd to the 12th, the 11th Commonwealth Games takes place in Edmonton, Alberta, and it promises to be just a tremendous show. We have a special feature for you. First of all, we're going to take a film look at some of the sights of the games, starting with the Commonwealth Stadium, 42,400 seats, the Argyle Velodrome, an outdoor facility with a concrete track. The diving and swimming events will take place at the Commonwealth Pool, which is part of the Kinsman Sports Center in Edmonton. Coliseum is going to be the host of the gymnastics and lacrosse events. The Strathcona Range, an impressive shooting facility, embracing ranges for shotgun, rifle, and pistol shooting competitions. Other sites include the Edmonton Gardens, where boxing will take place, the University of Alberta Ice Arena, where badminton will be featured, the Jubilee Auditorium, a site for weightlifting, and the main gymnasium of the University of Alberta, which will be host for the wrestling competition. Certainly an impressive list in a very impressive city. And we're very pleased that tonight, two people who will be very much involved in the Commonwealth Games are joining us. My immediate right is Wendy Quirk of the Pointe Claire Swimming Club here in the Montreal area, one of Canada's and indeed the world's top swimmers. And Rick Lachassure, the vice president of the Commonwealth Games in from Edmonton, is joining us as well. And Rick, I guess the first question has to be, is Edmonton all set for the big show? Are you ready?
We think less than 100 days to go now. The facilities are all finished with the exception of the lane of the track at the stadium, and we're really into the operational phase now.
The ticket sales, the money that's been collected and pledged and whatever, I understand it's a very impressive figure.
That's right. To date, we're close to the 60% of ticket sales, but we still have lots of tickets left and there's lots of good seats still available.
You know, Wendy Quirk called me, I think it was about a year ago, and asked me to pledge some support for in a swimathon. I said, hey, hang on, Wendy, wait a minute. You're going to break the bank. So she said, well, the maximum is so much. Wendy, what do the Commonwealth Games mean to young Canadian athletes as they get
Well, the Commonwealth Games are a very important game. It's the next biggest to the Olympic race. It means a lot to compete as Canada in the Commonwealth Games. And our team's going to get really ready to be a team for Canada.
Getting ready. What about the training routine? For example, someone like yourself, if you were involved, or all of the others, the swimmers and what have you. How does it compare to the training routine that was set up for the Montreal Olympics in 76?
Well, after our trials in July, there'll be a training camp where the whole team will get together and train for a few weeks before the games and get together and work together.
Rick, the here in Montreal, concerning the African Bloc Nations, political problems, of course, were very grave as far as the Montreal Olympics were concerned. What about the situation along those lines for your games in Edmonton?
Well, we were most pleased to announce today the acceptance of our invitation from Malawi and from Nigeria, and that brings to date 10 acceptances from the possible 13 nations. So we're most confident that the African nations are going to be with us in August.
What would be the approximate number of countries who will be involved when all is said and done and the opening ceremonies take place?
As of today, we're at 41 countries out of a possible 48, and we're still hoping for a couple more, which will be a record for the Commonwealth Games.
That's to be quite a shame. The swimming competition, of course, is always a highlight of a Commonwealth Games or an Olympic Games, and Canada did so well, Wendy, at the Olympics here in Montreal. Looking at the competition, looking at the countries entered for the Commonwealth Games, would you say that we are number one, really, if you can consider to be the favorite in the swimming competition?
Well, looking at the Olympics, I'd say we're number one. The Australians are going to be our main competition. I think they're going to be very close to us, unless, you know, we put on a good show. I think we will, though.
Have you seen that pool in Edmonton?
No, I haven't seen
it. I have, and it's a very, very impressive one indeed. Rick, just briefly to close things off, you mentioned 41 nations as of now. How many athletes total will be involved in Edmonton? Do you know, approximately?
We expect close to 2,000 in all 10 events, and we're really ready for them, and I think everyone will really enjoy the event, and I'm sure that when pool, because it is just a super pool.
Can you give us a very quick estimate of the number of spectators who will be involved and the people arriving to see the games?
If we sell all our tickets, we'll be close to 750,000 people that'll see at least one event, and we expect at least 50,000 people in from out of town.
Well, it should be a very, very successful international, indeed, Canadian sports event. Thank you very much for dropping by, Wendy and Rick, and the very best of luck to you both.
Thank you, Dick.
The Canadiens lead the Toronto Maple Leafs after 2 periods, 3-2, and we'll return with the Stanley Cup playoffs in just a moment.
Hold it, it's on my foot.
Mark, okay, where did you put it on your foot? Marty, I bet you're really handy around the house. Will we ever get this thing in? Come on. Okay. Let's get a little muscle into it.
Wait, I got it. This is going to give me the strength of 3 men here.
Okay, 1, 2. Beer down.
Yeah, I'm gonna tell you where it is as soon as we get the raft in the water. Exactly. Come on. 1, 2. Okay, give it a push. Go in the middle.
Marty and the boys get the old raft back in the water and treat themselves to a little Molson Export Ale.
Marty, we got the beer and you got the paddle. We're going up to the cottage. Stay with the ship. See you, Marty.
Molson Export Ale. It keeps on tasting great.
Disco Fever. Fever, 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 fever. Featuring Miko and Star Wars. Tavares.
Must be missing an angel.
Donna. In the stores now. 2 record sets, $6.99. Tape or cassette, $7.99. Keep your Saturday Night Fever alive all week long with Disco Fever. Fever, 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 fever.
The Maple Leafs 3-2 here at the Forum on the Ice. Back in his isolation booth, Donnie Marshall has been monitoring the Boston-Philadelphia game in the Boston Garden. Donnie, what's going on?
Oh, Dick, the third period score, 2-2. A good hockey game right now. The Bruins went ahead 2-1 after 2 on a goal by Don Marcotte. Flyers came back, goal by Barbie Clark at the 7-minute mark. It's very exciting. The play is moving both ends. The checking is relatively close, but the scoring chances are good, and they're excellent. We've had a couple of fights. Who do you think on Boston? Terry O'Reilly. He's been in it a couple of times, and he's been going at it pretty good. The game is excellent, and I would think that going later into the third period is going to get very tight, and they're not going to give too much. Here we go. John Rattel scored the first goal. He's going to set up Stan Jonathan. He's playing really well. He didn't have a point in the first series. Going to feed Jonathan across the front. Bernie Perrault lays the glove down, makes a super stop there, and that's goes on itself.
Right, playing very well. Perrault playing well, too, because he was thought to be a big man.
He is playing well. He's standing up very well. And here's a goal by Don Marcotte. Park leading Schmatz. Schmatz is going to hit. Perrault's going to hold the puck against the point. And Don Marcotte's going to break to the front of the net, just get the stick down on it away from Bob Daly, and really... Daly had him tied up quite well, but he just got the stick down to get it out of there. And here's the goal by Bobby Clark. Brad Park, who's been on the ice and been the center of everything as far as the puck is concerned, gets tied up a little bit. Clark is going to come pick up the puck. He'll feed Bill Barber moving in from the point. Barber's shot will hit the post. Cheevers will be out of position. Bobby Clark has the whole net, and he's just going to run it in without any trouble. That's 7 minutes in the third period, Dick, 2-2.
I take it, Donnie, from your remarks that these teams... Bruins have been off, 9 days now, and the Flyers have been off a week. Would you say they showed any signs of the rust developing earlier on, or have they pretty well gotten away from that?
No, I don't think there's any rust. They're not hitting. It's not a physical game similar to the Toronto Islander game, but it's a good hockey game. They're using the body, taking people out of the play, but just interesting in that the play is going up and down. The goaltenders are getting work.
Okay, Donnie, thank you very much, and we'll bring you goals from that game as they occur during the third period.
Play is on in the third period. 58 seconds left in the penalty to Boutet. And the Canadiens with a 3-2 lead on the power play. They're led by Guy Lafleur, who hits the Toronto line. Slashes it in there way wide. And there's Jung Johansson with it. And he sends Montreal back down the ice. Dryden is watching Jones, number 16. Now there are 33 seconds left in the penalty, and Robinson playing it off the board for Schutt. Coming out with Robinson, Lafleur, and Lemaire. Robinson over to Lafleur, dropping it back. Here's Schutt shooting it. Loose in front of the net. Robinson tied up by Turnbull. Johansson takes Robinson in on the boards. They struggle for it. Now Butler has it. The penalty has 10 seconds left, and the Canadiens are not going to have time for another power play rush, because out of the penalty box now, stepping onto the ice is Boutet. Forechecking is Jones. The shot's on goal. Not too much offense in that second period. 7-4 for Montreal. 29-9 at the present time. Now the Leafs trying to hem Montreal in. Montreal getting it out. Carlisle slapped it in. And it's called on the offside. Chico, do you make your off-season home in New York?
I stay there for a while. Then I head on out to Minnesota for a little rest and relaxation and kind of unwind and get tuned up for the next season back in New York.
New Yorker watching you, pleasure. This team is going into New York over the WOR, and they're satisfied with your work. I just got word back.
Oh, well, that's good to hear. That's a good hockey town, New York. There's a lot more hockey fans there than a lot of people realize.
Now it's Nyroff into the center ice area. Four-man attack, and his shot is blocked by Glenny. It whips back in on the right side by Sittler. Sittler has been unable to get on track here. There's a shot by Carlisle, high and wide. Sittler centering it. Ganey has it, plays it to center. Left there. Lead pass, Regin Uhl from Jarvis. Carlisle takes Uhl in on the board. Carlisle coming up with it. Now Savard into Jarvis. Here's Uhl trying to center it. It's off a leg. Nyroff fading to the right side into the corner pass. Glenny centered it. Now racing in for it is Jarvis. Jarvis shooting the most impossible angle. Here's Savard almost fanned on it. Carlisle with it. Ahead to Sittler with Lanny McDonald at center. McDonald over the line. He has a great wrist shot, but he was low and wide with that one. In on the boards they go. McDonald trying to get it loose, but it's held there for a whistle. From the Forum of Montreal, this is Stanley Cup 78.
Hey there with that car to buy.
Grow with us.
Hey there with that knot to tie.
Grow with us. Adding on that extra room, going off to college soon. Come on, everybody.
Everybody grow with us.
Scotia Plan Loans. Cost convenient way to get yourself growing in dozens of ways right now.
Come to Scotia Bank and grow with us. Grow with us. Grow with us. Grow with us.
Harold Ballard and King Clancy of the Maple Leafs. Clancy was refereeing a rough game one time. He was going to bring the players to center for the face-off. Didn't have a puck, but he said, forget about the puck, let's get on with the game. He liked them rough. He was a colorful individual. Still is one of the great ambassadors of hockey, King Clancy. Now Risebrough with Lombay. Risebrough shooting it. High and wide. Boucher laying it in behind. Risebrough is belted behind the net by Williams and Johansson. Now Risebrough has the cross the board. In behind the net to Cornwallier, trying to jam it in from the short side. Now, Bouchard at the point. There it is. It's finally coming down. Waiting for the score! Oh,
Canadiens go back up by two. Chico, that was a very strange play. The way puck seemed to just be locked. Right here from Bouchard's shot.
You see there, it hits Darryl Sittler's stick, and Lanny takes a swipe at it. And again, a nice play there. I think who give it over there to Cornwallier? Risebrough. Smart play. Just poked it through the traffic there. And see, Johansson's got Cornwallier's stick there. He lets it go, plays the puck, and boom, it's in the net.
Second goal of the game for Ivan Cornwallier, who continues to have a good playoff year for the Canadiens. And it's 4-2 Montreal.
12, Ivan Cornwallier. Assist number 8, Doug Risebrough. And number 26, Pierre Bouchard. At 3 minutes, 14 seconds.
3 minutes and 14 seconds, the time of the goal. Cornwallier for Risebrough and Bouchard. Canadiens leading it 4-2. Now, Carlisle from the line. It went off Lafleur. Carlisle lights it up on the right side. He fired it in. Jones, number 16, moving in with Williams and Butler. Savard to Robinson. Ahead to shot to center. It goes. Glennie hands it off. Jones. There's a little fella going. Puts on the brake. Lost it. Savard to Lafleur. Now ahead it goes. Shot couldn't get that lead pass from Lemaire. And it is icing against the Canadiens.
This series shifts to Maple Leaf Gardens for games 3 and 4. This coming Saturday night and then next Tuesday. And, of course, Hockey Night in Canada will be on hand to cover the action every game of the series. Leaf subscribers have until this coming Friday to pick up their tickets for game 4 and a possible game 6. So if you're one of the lucky ones that have garden tickets, make sure you pick them up before the box office closes on Friday.
We just had a shot there, Mr. Ballard, Danny, and I'm sure you're aware he became an instant celebrity in the playoffs in New York this year. Because when we were up in Toronto, of course, he wouldn't play the American National Anthem, and there were all kinds of signs. He became a celebrity with things he was saying in the paper, and so everybody recognizes that name now.
Well, Harold Ballard is colorful, makes great copy, and a very astute sports promoter. Now, Williams losing it to Lemaire, off the board. Lemaire over on the other side, Robinson moving in, he chopped it in, shut. Coming at Carlisle, here's Ellis with Williams at center. Ellis firing it in. Off the board. There's Williams. And it's poked away by Savard to Lafleur. Shot it from the left side. Mayer is trailing. Here's Lafleur taking the look. Lafleur still with it. Here's Robinson back to Lafleur. And the Leafs come up with it. Savard keeping it in. Savard twisting and turning. Robinson at the other side. A shot by Schott. To the boards it goes. Schott with Ferguson after him. Turnbull leading a Leaf attack into the center ice area. Ellis moving up. Here's Turnbull going in, and he fired it. And every time that number 2 Turnbull gets across the opposition line, there he is again. He had trouble finding it that time. And he tripped Lemaire. Lafleur turning on the jet. Lafleur gets to do it right over first. Oh, Lemaire missed a glorious setup. And what stick handling by Lafleur. Bondu, Williams after him. They're down on the ice. Williams has it ahead to Ferguson on the right wing. Butler chasing it. Lapointe stopped it. Now Lambert, who was set up just a moment ago in beautiful fashion by Lafleur. Going into the corner. Here's Lambert taking a look. He centered it at Mrs. Cournoyer. Butler on the right side with Maloney off Maloney's stick, and Nyrop feeds it over to Lapointe. Lapointe into the center ice area, drills the shot into the corner. McDonald in pursuit is Lambert. Good move by McDonald ahead to Weir. Weir into the area. Maloney couldn't pick it up, and he strides in behind the Canadian set trying to center it. Here's Weir getting it back. McDonald fired on it. He was set up beautifully in the slot. McDonald feeds it back in. Nyrop hustles, taken into the boards by Weir. Maloney jammed by Nyrop. Bondu holds it, and the whistle goes to stop the play.
Tonight's Stanley Cup game is coming to you from the Forum in Montreal.
Defense of Carlisle and Glennie well in over the line. Here's Weir getting it back. It's intercepted. Oh, who played it out. McDonald to Carlisle. Carlisle has looked rather impressive, particularly with his rushing here tonight. That's number 23. Keep your eye on him. He's a youngster with tremendous enthusiasm and a fair amount of talent. There's Carlisle over to Boutet along the board. Ganey gets rid of it down. It goes. Carlisle is after it. Put it right on Ganey's stick. There's Ganey shooting it, and a big leg save by Paul Mateer. Canadians almost cashed in on an estate. That time by Carlisle after we gave him the big buildup. There's a good move over on the other side by Boutet with Weir in over the line. Boutet going to the ice along with Uhl and the Canadiens. Ganey. He strides into the center ice area. He gets tied up with Glennie. 12 minutes and 20 seconds left in the third period, and Weir lugs it in over the Canadiens' line to the slot. Over it goes to Boutet. Boutet in the corner, struggling with Lafleur for possession, and the play is done.
Captain Ivan Cornway with two goals tonight now has a playoff career total of 63. That moves him ahead of Bobby Hull in the all-time NHL goal-scoring list and up in the fourth place. Game two here at the Forum in Montreal Thursday night. We'll be on the air at 8 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time. 12:09 left in the third period, and this one, the Canadiens with a 4-2 lead over Toronto.
And the shots on goal at this point in the third period, 31, Montreal 9, Toronto. So Toronto hasn't had a shot in this period. There's Turnbull. His shot was aimed for the net, but it hit a player, Johansson. Back to his own line. Out it goes to Ellis. Ellis to Slipper. Williams lost it to Robinson. Leafs on it. It changed there. The quarters were close in the center ice area. Now Turnbull up on the right side for Ellis. He hits the line, goes to the other side, and is golfed down the ice by Cournoyer and Turnbull back there. And it's racing against Montreal.
This is Stanley Cup 78 from the Montreal Forum.
What's it take to a great light beer?
You gotta have heart, mouth and mouth and mouth and heart.
If you're gonna brew a beer with great taste,
there's only one.
Scotty Bowman back at the Canadiens bench tonight, coaching in his 125th Stanley Cup playoff game.
Sittler, number 27, will face off against 21, Jaffers of Montreal, and again the lead with the defense under your picture, but they're on the points, Johansson and Turnbull. Robinson riding out. Headmans it, Jarvis has it, dumped it into the corner. Ganey coming in from the left side against Butler. Now Williams goes after it. The Leafs need two goals to get back on even terms. Turnbull broke his stick, and now he holds it there for a faceoff. 4-2, Montreal leading.
Broke his stick on the referee's skate. I don't have to tell Chico Rice that Ivan Cornway is quite a sniper. He has 6 goals in the playoffs, Chico, on 7 shots.
Not a bad percentage, is it, Dick? But, you know, I was speaking. We had heard through the grapevine that Mr. Cornway was having just a great series, you know, in Chicago and the end of the season. And to see him now, it's unbelievable how he's regained that youthful enthusiasm, and he's just flying out there. He's really been the spark, I think, on their offense all night. And he's been taking a beating in front of the net there, too, Dick. They've been working him over pretty good.
A chance for Montreal with their defense in over the Toronto line. Jones got the draw. Johansson has got to be very pleasing. Here's the first goal!
Cena Perry's first goal of this series, and Chico gives the Canadiens a 5-2 lead, but I think right here we see young Trevor Johansson with a rookie mistake, perhaps.
Yeah, Jimmy Jones did the job by getting the face-off. There's Steve Shutt, knowing where LaFleur is most of the time, just threw it out there. And, you know, it's funny to... Here it is again. Again, not a particularly hard shot, but very accurate, which Mr. LaFleur does real well. But it's kind of interesting to see what he scores here. It's like, now the night's complete. Not only are they ahead comfortably, but Mr. LaFleur got a goal. And that seems to make everybody a little happier.
Glittering scoring chance that was, with Shutt set up beautifully by LaFleur. Now Turnbull up on the left side. In over the Canadiens line. Couldn't get by Savard. Savard poked it to Lemire at center. He was bumped by Butler. Here's LaFleur with it. LaFleur, a wizardry effort on the stick handling. There's the shot, a weak one by Shutt. Back to Robinson. He fired at a volunteer. Picked up a screenshot in that right glove hand. Here's Carlisle. Long shot. And Dryden has had very little to do tonight. That is the 10th shot on goal for Toronto. So the Leafs' offensive effort has been very disappointing here tonight. They're behind 5-2 right here. Lambert in for Mondeau. Here's Glennie. Glennie at center up on the left side. Boutet caromed it off the board. Ellis coming from the other side. Robinson to Cornwallé. Out over the line it goes. Carlisle tied up by Lambert. Cornwallé looking for some skating room. He lost it. Maloney can't get anywhere against Robinson. Lambert to Cornwallé to Mondeau. He overskated it. Following up, Lambert shooting it in. 5-2, Montreal over Toronto. 9 minutes and 20 seconds left in this, the third period. Here's Maloney shooting it way off the target. Robinson clearing it ahead. Comes to center. Lambert on the left side. He's over the line shooting it. And that one off Glennie's stick, well up over the glass.
With the score, Montreal 5, Toronto 2. This is Stanley Cup 78.
Fairmont, fuel efficient, space efficient, cost efficient. Fairmont has outstanding mileage ratings.
These days, the higher the better.
Fairmont gives you the most room for the money of any car in its class.
Helps keep the kids off your back.
Fairmont has the lowest suggested price of any car in its class.
We'd love it even without the low price, but not as much.
Test drive Fairmont at your Ford dealer. The better ideas keep coming from Ford.
Montreal Canadiens lead the Toronto Maple Leafs 5-2, but at the Boston Garden, the Bruins and the Philadelphia Flyers have gone into overtime, 2-2 at the end of regulation time.
Now it's clear down on the right side. And LaPointe touching it, and it's icing against the Toronto Maple Leafs. The Toronto team has a fine dedicatory approach to hockey, and we mention that because there you see him again. Here is the fellow responsible. His philosophy is dedicate yourself, and work is the most important ingredient of the successful formula. You don't agree with that, do you?
I couldn't have said it any better, Danny.
Is that right?
You should have been a coach. Or at least a script writer.
You may be coach of the Islanders. Now it's into the corner. There's Risebrow pouncing on the centering it. And Weir. There is bump by Rajan. Now Maloney. Over to Ellis. Ellis bumping with Bouchard. Here's Turnbull. He's dangerous all the time. Oh, that went. That's right. He's going to be teamed up with Luke Turnbull every night he's out there, the way he's having trouble with Turnbull's shot. Now Risebrow. There's a shot. The board. Johansson up on the right side. Ellis handing it off to Weir. Weir over the line, takes a look. The pass goes to Maloney. Quick shot. Driving at that left leg. Oops, and Rapier leg size from there.
Scoring plays in this period. Cornwallier from Rice, Brown, and Bouchard at 3:14, and then Lafleur from Schutt at 8:54. Pierre Bouchard picking up an assist on that goal by Cornwallier that made it a 4-2 hockey game. And that was a very, very large tally on behalf of the Canadiens. 32-12, the overall shot right now.
Face-off, Savard hands it off to Robinson. Time becoming a big factor here for Toronto. They're down by 3 goals, 5-2. We're into the third period, 7:50 left. Now from the corner, Glennie failed to clear it out against Chartrand. Here's Carlisle, McDonald. A pass stopped by Chartrand. Now Sittler into the center ice area. Rolled it into Canadian territory, McDonald. Robinson. Robinson is then bumped by Williams, who went down. And Williams got the worst of that exchange in Canadian territory. Carlisle with Robinson it back to the Leafs defenseman. Randy McDonald whipped in a weak rolling shot. And it has settled down to a fairly predictable right here with the Canadians, the 2-goal lead. They're going to get it and get rid of it, get it out over the line. As you see right there, Toronto doing some forward checking, but they can't get there. Here's Ganey, lost it. Jarvis back to Savard. Savard into the center ice area, flicked it into the corner, and back into the corner is Ganey ahead to McDonald. He was checked by a shot. Now Canadians are going to move up and try to keep the pressure on the Leafs in their own zone. But Toronto getting it out. Here's Sittler ahead to McDonald, and he's called on the offside.
This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from the Forum in Montreal.
Share of the family income makes a lot of sense to a lot of women these days. And so does buying life insurance. Think about your future and talk it over with a Mutual Life of Canada agent.
Life is a mutual.
And there is the statistical story. Third period, 5-2. Montreal leading, 6:27 left in this. The third period. Nyrop on it, beating it back in. Right on Paul Mateer. And that is the 33rd shot on goal for the Canadians in this game. The Leafs now have an even dozen, so there's a tremendous disparity in shots on goal. There's a shot by Butler, knocked away by Nyrop. Leafs on it again. Jones getting it back to Butler. Sharp angle shot. Canadians getting it out. Here's Lemaire, shot going in on the other side. The shot, he fired, and he was being well checked by Jones. And he really couldn't get a good bead on it. the tier because number 16, Jones, was doing an excellent job. Now Boutet, rink-wide pass to Johansson, to Jones at center, along with Turnbull going in, firing at the rebound. Another shot. They score! On the rebound. And it is 5-3 in the lead. Within two with 5:28 left.
Valley and Turnbull again playing a very key role for Toronto. Chico, he lets this one go, and the Canadians couldn't corral the rebound.
Just doesn't seem to be Kenny Dryden's night. Even when he made a good save, then the rebound comes and through the legs. And really, you know, as bad as it looks sometimes going through the legs, when the goaltender's moving across, you're most vulnerable through the legs. And again, like you say, Ian Turnbull, they're really making the play. And a nice play by Patty Boutet, who I played with in college. So if somebody had a score at this point, I'm glad it was Pat. By the way, 2 minutes left, and they've capitalized on most of their chances, Toronto has. So one more, and they're right back in it.
This is number two, Ian Turnbull, and number 16, Jimmy Jones, at 14 minutes, 32 seconds.
14:32 is the time of the goal. To recap for you, Boutet from Turnbull and Jones. And there's that name, Jones, again. Turnbull, we've been hearing about him throughout the entire playoff setup.
Yeah, they've been doing the job, both those two, and like we talked about earlier, you know, it's the guys that maybe don't have the big year, the season during the year, that come up for you in the playoffs. And you know, it's funny, what Montreal does now, they give up a goal here, and they kind of almost tease you, and they'll make a bad play like that, but it's going to be interesting now that it's getting close again. Now they'll turn it on, and it seems to be Canadians' pattern where they just make enough mistakes to think you can beat them, but yet you never seem to do it. And
there's a shot. That was almost a goal. Mondeau working the corner right out in front. And Lambert failed to deflect it. Here's Maloney. Maloney in over the line. Dryden fans, strike one on him. But back it is at the line. Toronto keeping it in. Maloney jammed in on the board. Here's Ronnie Ellis getting it back. And Cornwallé slapped it to the boards where it's picked up by Mondeau. Carlisle ahead to Maloney with Ellis over on the left side, offside with Ferguson going in.
Thursday afternoon at 3:30 Eastern Daylight Time, a reminder that CBC Radio will bring you the World Hockey Tournament game between Canada and Czechoslovakia live from Prague, Czechoslovakia. Team Canada and Czechoslovakia Thursday at 3:30 Eastern Time on CBC Radio.
The attendance tonight, 16,363. That is the largest turnout for the four playoff games here. But Dick, before you go, I thought we'd have more than that.
Good eye, Danny. The buildup was something for this, certainly far greater than for the Detroit series.
Okay, you can go now. Chico and I will stay here. Face off. Outside. Just inside. The Montreal blue line. And a goal here by Toronto would make it rather dicey.
In this position, and they've come up big in the last few minutes of the game, so I think they probably feel pretty confident. They've been getting the bounces, Danny.
They have Lanny McDonald out there along with Ferguson and Williams. It's back into Canadian territory. Superb. Got it out over the line. Now it's back in, and Williams called on the offside. From the Forum in Montreal, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Superstars of the 100th year, starring Tom Jones, Ellen Reddy,
Delta Dawn,
Paul Anka,
having my baby.
20 superstars, including Barry Manilow, Neil Sedaka.
They say that breaking up is hard to do.
Engelbert Humperdinck. Superstars of the 100th year, disc $6.99, tape $7.99.
Well, Coach Nielsen will have to utilize the big guns as much as possible from here in, wouldn't you think, Ben?
Well, they're definitely going to have to change their style a little bit. Like I said, Danny, as boring as it may seem to the fans and the people that want to see good hockey, to beat Montreal, you're going to have to dump the... Especially, you know how they blitz you for, a minute or two, and that's usually when they capitalize. Against us, Toronto would dump it out or tie it up, and it made for a boring game, but really, it's the only way you can defense against a team as strong offensively as Montreal.
Okay. Now it is Sittler getting it back to Clinton. Williams and McDonald up at the Canadiens' line. The pass intercepted by Gainey. Into his own zone. Passes on the left side to Williams. Here's Clinton. Carlisle at center. Four leaps up. They clear it. It's kept in. Now Savard going after it. Savard ahead on the left side to Gainey. Gainey coming in over the line. He barges into the corner. Gainey bumping with Glenny. Chartrand and Carlisle move in, and that brings them to the stoppage of play with 3 minutes and 19 seconds left in regulation time.
Danny, you've been asking all the questions tonight. I've got one question. Now, you've seen Montreal all year. Now, if you were the coach, how honestly, what's your theory on how to beat them? Say, if you've got a team like Toronto or any team, Boston, Philly, the Islanders, what do you think the secret is to maybe beating them?
Well, the way to beat them is to stay on top of forechecking, but how do you do it successfully? They take that type of play away from you, and they kill you with their forechecking.
True. That's true. You know, you say take the body, but... You know, that's hard to do, too, and that's why I say, really, the only thing, to most coaches, it seems that you've got to get the puck out of your end any way you can, and don't let them get started.
I think Bowman was prepared for a physical game because he had Bouchard and Chartrand out there, but this has not been a physical game.
No, not at all.
And I think, that rather wisely, Toronto decided they would not play it as roughly. Now Toronto going in, Bouchard passing it back, and Lapointe knocked it to the corner. Now Boutette, twisting and turning, Toronto in over the Canadiens' line. Boutette making some good moves. There's the shot. And Turnbull again taking the shot, but it was deflected by a stick over the glass.
I don't want this taken the wrong way, Danny, but I think, I give Nielsen credit, I think they realize that they played a grueling series. Now, they can't go out and hit Montreal for seven games the way they did us. And I would say they're not going to give these two games to Montreal, but I think they're really building for those two games at home, and I think you'll see them resort to that once they regain their strength and get a little bit of their fatigue back. And I think in Toronto, you'll see it similar to the way they played against us.
But after all, their objective has to be to get a split here in those two games.
Yes, I would think so.
Now here's Butler, weak shot. Lafleur, a break for the Canadiens. They had the shot. Shot going in, a goal, fired! Bombardier, he got a piece of that one. Bombardier coming up big on that 34th Canadian. Goal, Turnbull shooting it. And that's off the leg of Lapointe. It's centered through the crease. Lafleur, into the corner. Lafleur just gets rid of it. It rolls down into Toronto territory. Montreal over Toronto, 2 minutes and 12 seconds left in the third period. Lapointe ahead to Cournoyer. Cournoyer firing and off the board. Carlisle twisting and turning to the other side it goes. Now Glennie up on the right side. Play to the center to Sittler. Here's Sittler at the line. It's off his... Canadiens, Risebrough back with Ull. Risebrough fakes the shot. Now he's going to take it. Oh, what a split save there by Palmatier. Now Savard in the favorite Savardian spinorama moves, comes back through center, clearing it in. McDonald over to Glennie. Glennie, right wing pass to McDonald. McDonald winds up for the shot. Oh, he whistled that one, but he was wide with it. Now Savard against McDonald. Cournoyer out over the line. Ahead to Chartrand. Chartrand against Carlisle. They jam in on the boards. It's kicked in by Chartrand. And a minute and 7 seconds left in the third period. Now McDonald on the right side. Having difficulty against the bird. 1 minute left. There's Sittler in there. Behind the net, Jarvis. At the point, it's going to be kept in by Glennie. There's the shot. Robinson breaks it out. He hustles out with Gainey. Back to Gainey. Gainey shooting it. Oh, that was a hard one. This is Stanley Cup 78 for Montreal.
How long do you want your car to last?
A million miles. She's already done 89,000, and the only thing I've ever done to the engine is tune it up.
Of course, I check it regularly. And the only motor oil I've ever used in my car is Quaker State.
Quaker State can't promise everyone the kind of mileage Julian Fry gets, but Quaker State helps cars last. And that's a fact.
I guess that's why Quaker State's the best-selling motor oil in North America.
45 seconds left. Fades off to the rate of Paul Matier. He continues to come up with some fine saves.
You got to hand it to him. He's hanging right in there to the end, and who knows? Like you say, one good shot here, but he's made a couple good saves here in the last couple minutes.
Turnbull bumped by Ganey. Weird. Johansson ahead on the right. Ellis. In over the line. Back to Maloney. There's the shot just wide. He hit something on that shot. But he was wide. Back it goes. To the lead zone. Over to Maloney. Ahead. Weir trying to pick it up in fine style. Lost his balance. Now there's an offside and 17 seconds left in the third period.
You know, Danny, I don't... Earlier, you know, like after the game here, Leafs are probably going to think, boy, you know, we got three goals and we missed some good chances. Canadians had some flaws. And that's what I was talking about earlier, where the Canadians do enough bad things at times where you think they can be beat, but yet they can still turn it on when they have to. And that's why a game like tonight, although the Leafs got beat, I don't think it's going to hurt them psychologically that much, because they're going to think, hey, you know, we just play a little bit better and we can beat them.
Now it's Maloney. Shooting it into the corner. Digging in there is Williams. Ferguson going after it. Lost it to Hull. There's Maloney getting a shot. It's off a stick. Cornwallier carrying it down on the right side. That'll be the hockey game. 5-10 for game. Montreal out shooting Toronto 36-15. And the Canadians off the bench to congratulate Dryden. However, he had a pretty easy night, but they're out there to congratulate Paul Matier. Boston and Philadelphia in overtime. Boston won the game. We'll get you the score. It had to be 3-2, but I want to get the score if possible. It'll be relayed. So there you have the final score. As you see the Leafs going to their dressing room, 5-3 for Montreal. In just a moment, our three-star selection.
What's it take to brew a great light beer?
You gotta have heart, mazel, mazel, mazel heart.
If you're gonna brew a beer with great taste,
there's only one place to start. Mosel Light has got heart, 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 miles and miles of heart, heart, heart. Mosel Light has got heart.
In your garage?
Ideas for having fun, ideas to really think about, ideas for everyone.
See your Ford dealer. He's got Ford Fairmonts with outstanding fuel economy ratings and front-wheel drive Fiestas with one of the best fuel economy ratings of any car sold in Canada. Plus, high-mileage rated Pintos and Mustangs. See all the high-mileage rated cars at your Ford dealer. The better ideas keep coming from Ford.
Ladies and gentlemen, here are tonight's Molson's three stars, selected by Mr. Al Strachan, the sports editor for the Montreal Gazette. Let me introduce the first star, Jacques Lemay. Introducing me to the second star, Yvon Cournoyer. Et la troisième étoile, the third star, Larry Robinson.
We'll return with Stanley Cup 78 in just a moment.
Down by the old,
down by the old mill stream,
old mill stream,
where I first
met you,
16.
If you have to have a meeting and can't go, a conference call gets different people in different cities together to work out whatever they're working on. Just dial zero, ask for the conference operator. She sets it all up.
You're about to be welcomed to one of the best hotels in the world. The hotel.
hotels with the best locations, near the things you need to be near. The hotels with the best system of standards for taking care of you. The hotels that take care of more travelers than anybody else. Holiday Inn welcomes you to some of the best hotels in the world.
I'm a music lover, but I'm no engineer, right, Stanley?
Uh-huh.
Well, last time I went shopping for stereo, I was so busy checking out the specifications that I didn't have time to listen to the music. So today, I brought Stanley along. He's an audiophile, right, Stanley?
Uh-huh.
He checked out the specs while I concentrated on the music. And we both agreed on Sansui. Beautiful engineering, beautiful music. Sansui. There's even music in the name. Right, Stanley? Stanley?
Just to update things, the game in Boston is over as Rick Middleton scored for the Bruins early in overtime, I would assume, and the Bruins win it by a score of 3-2. So they take a 1-0 lead in that semifinal here in Montreal. The Canadiens defeated the Toronto Maple Leafs 5-3, so they take a 1-0 lead in this particular semifinal. Punch Imlach is here, and he's going to be joining us in just a few minutes, but Punch was just telling me that he has not seen Yvan Cornoyer play as well as he played tonight in quite some time. It's a pretty good compliment, Captain, from a fellow who certainly knows more than a little bit about this hockey game. Congratulations on 2 goals, 6 goals, and 7 shots in the playoffs. What's the secret?
Well, I think, you know, you got to be there in the right time, and the playoff, you got to play defensive too. You know, goals are pretty good, but if you don't win the game, they're not too good, so you got to play both sides.
Start at the beginning, Yvan, you fellas had the layoff. Kenny Dryden was wondering about it before the game in a brief chat with me. How about the layoff, and how did you feel as the game began?
Well, I don't like it too much. You get very high for the game, and you get 5 games in yourself, and after you got to wait another week, and you got to practice again, and you got to build up yourself again. I don't like it too much, but we got to take it. You know, maybe the other team are a little bit tired too, so maybe it's a good thing for us for the second game.
We're going to look at your second goal, Yvan, the one in the second period, or the third period rather, to give you the 4-2 lead. A good play by Doug Reisbrow after Bouchard's shot was deflected.
Yes, I look, the shot there was in the air and very high, and I look at the puck, and I just hope till the puck passed through, but Dougie, and I just missed my chance there. I was ready for the puck there.
You fellas had a very fast start. You had 21 shots in the first period. Paul Montier had a tremendous first period. Was that part of Scotty's game plan, go after them right away offensively?
Well, yeah, as you know, when Montreal, they used to be good. They used to be good in the first period, and they got to go all out. I remember against Chicago my first year, we scored 4 goals in 10 minutes. So I think that's the way we got to go. We got to go all out in the playoffs.
I thought in the first period particularly tonight, the Leafs tried to play it pretty tough. Were they as physical, especially at the start of the game, as you thought they might be?
Well, I think so. Maple Leaf in the playoff, they always take the men a lot. I still remember the last game we lost in the playoff in Toronto. That was a hard hitting, and I don't forget that easy. We prepare for that, and we know they're going to take the men, and we're going to have to do the same thing.
One final question. You mentioned about the practicing and so on. You really did not know until that game Saturday night who you'd be playing here at the Forum tonight. In the intervening time, is it possible? Could you practice as if you were playing the Leafs? Did it make a difference to your practice?
Well, I don't think so. Any team is going to be hard. You got to practice the best that you can, because anybody you're going to meet there is going to be hard. You know, the playoffs is not easy, and everybody gave more than 100%. So if it's the Leafs, we know the Leafs are going to be hungry, and you know if it's Philadelphia, they're going to be hungry too. So we got to be ready for both teams.
And they're going to be hungry Thursday night as well.
I think so.
Yvan Cornoyer, congratulations on 2 goals, one of the star selections in the game.
Thank you very much.
All right, we'll go back upstairs now to the broadcast booth and rejoin Danny Gallivan and Chico Resch.
Okay, Dick and Yvan Cornoyer, before I have a very long question to ask you, but before we get to that, looking at Yvan Cornoyer there, you know, he's been scoring very well of late, and I think one of the reasons he's shooting the puck, and I think he is one of the best wrist shots in hockey. As a goalie, you tell me.
Well, you know, when I was back still playing junior, I remember reading an article in Sports Illustrated about Yvan Cornoyer shooting these lead pucks for his wrist shot. And I always suspected that he must have quite a wrist shot, but the first couple of years I played in the league, Yvan relied more on a slap shot. But like you, we were talking, I guess he's gotten back to the wrist shot. And even like the goals that are scored, if you really look at them, most of them are on wrist shots and not the big slap shot. And I think that, you know, he's just smart enough to realize, you know, that's where his bread and butter is, in his wrist shot.
Okay, Chico, the profound question.
What has Toronto got to do on Thursday night to win the game? I know facetiously you can say score more goals than Montreal. We know that, but in their style of play, what have they got to do?
They can't put 10 men on the ice, can they? No. So that's no. And I hate to say this, because the one thing Montreal has going for them is that so many people overrate them other teams. And when I talk like that, everybody must think that I think Toronto doesn't have a chance. It's not that as much as the fact that what I think they're going to have to do is dump that puck out and slow the game down. As much as you don't want to hear that, Danny, and some of the fans, they're really going to have to, because nobody, I don't think in the world, can skate with Montreal. And we talked about trying to forecheck them, but really, how do you do that with that mobility they have on their defense? How do you really tie them up? And they can make that long pass, and there's somebody always in motion. So I think it is really, as much as I hate to say it for the good of hockey, it's trying to slow them down to the Leafs' level.
Well, one of the great aspects of sport, of course, is unpredictability. I go back to the Detroit series. Canadians won that handily 6-2, and everybody says, oh, this is just a walk. What happens the next night? Detroit comes on. So we could have just a whale of a hockey game here on Thursday night.
I think you're going to see the Leafs putting more on the line. I'm not saying they took it easy tonight, but I think they're going to be much more prepared come Thursday, because like we talked about, they have to win one game. And it's generally considered in any sport that second game in the other team's building is the one you're really key to try and win. And like you say, I think Thursday could be a much different game.
Well, this is a bit of a cliche about a letdown after a series. Did that enter into it as far as Toronto was concerned in that game tonight, after up so high to win that seventh game against you people?
I would say honestly, yes, for two reasons. One, they played very physical against us, and that's just tiring by the law of your body. You hit enough and you're going to get tired. And secondly, I thought this series, because of the rivalry, and you know, everybody's either a Leaf fan or a Canadian fan in Canada, and then they have their other teams besides. So I thought it would be an emotional series, and you can only go to the well so many times, and I think Coach Nielsen and the entire Leaf team feels that way, and I think they're going to have to kind of regroup their emotion and that the drive and that into that one game. And like you say,